the cards were kind of stacked against Ottawa last week. I mean, you had the Laurier's homecoming, a must win for Ottawa or for Laurier, and I think it just got Ottawa kind of got caught in the Laurier storm. I think this week Ottawa's got to go back to basics, determine where the what and where they went wrong, if you will, against Laurier. I mean, clearly, Nate, we're not going to make something that it's not. Ottawa is a prohibitive favorite in this game, and I think you're going to see the coaches approach it as such, but also approach it as somewhat of a learning experience from in terms of being able to build on this, if you will, for the rest of the season.
Quite honestly, Nate, I feel sorry for the York University Lions today. Wow, after a thrashing like that on national television, I expect nothing but a dominant performance by the GGs today on both sides of the ball. I expect JP Aslan to have his team very well prepared today. And again, I'm looking for a big, big win for the GGs.
Yeah, and of course, the GGs, like I say, we're not going to gild the lily here. I mean, it is what it is. In terms of the matchup in our CIS blog pool this week, I think Ottawa was installed as a 25-point favorite.
Rightfully so.
And but overall, I mean, the GGs win this. They get to 4-2. They put themselves in good position to still be in the hunt to host a playoff game. There's another game in the OUA today with playoff implications taking place tonight down the 401 in Windsor, the 4-1 nationally 10th-ranked Windsor Lancers.
A very nice surprise to see, actually.
Hosting Queens, which is, I think, coming in at 3-2 and still in the mix, although Ottawa's got the tiebreaker over them thanks to that win back on September 10th.
Well, we all knew it was going to be a bit of a transition year, having lost, you know, of course, Brad Sinopoli, the head Creighton winning quarterback for us last year, and as well some other key players such as Cyril Adjedi. But at the same time, you know, this is what we've come to expect from the University of Ottawa to become one of the better programs in the OUA.
Yeah. GGs will be kicking off. Matt Falvo, the do-everything kicker from Welland, Ontario, ready to put boot to ball.
The Niagara region.
Nice. Devontae Hobbs back deep, along with Curtis Price for the York Lions, who are coming off a 48-23 loss last week at the University of Western Ontario's homecoming. Actually had the Mustangs down 10-0 after a quarter. Managed to be a bit of a buzzkill for about 15 minutes, and then the natural order restored itself.
Well, clearly the Mustangs are the class of the OUA this year.
And it's definitely looking that way. Sort of Mac, Windsor are looking pretty good, but a lot of uncertainty with those teams. Kickoff taken by Price at the 3. Slow start up the left side as the blocking forms. Looks to get to the outside, and the GGs bring him down at around the York 21, which is where the Lions will start.
This is where we're going to see some improvement this week, Nate. I definitely think, I mean, Ottawa's got to look at this as one of the resources. And we said this last time they were at home, Nate. Special teams is a battle that they have to win. And I think, like I said, I think after the Laurier game, panic can't set in. I mean, that's one game. That's not the result they expected. But I definitely think you'll see a return to basics approach and see what works, what doesn't. Let's build on this and start to put ourselves, as Bob Knight once said, the great basketball coach, put themselves in position to be in position when the time comes.
Yep. Dimitar Sevden opens that quarterback for York. You'll see Nick Kachua about. Looked like there was some early movement by the Lions, and they'll march back 5 yards. So inauspicious first snap for the York offense as they look to get their bearings here on this what's a long road trip for York coming up down from Toronto.
Certainly not the start the coaching staff was looking for, Nate.
Well, we saw in the last couple of games, Nate, where I believe the last game at home we saw where Ottawa kind of got off to the slow start, and it was Toronto that got off to the kind of start. So maybe this is a good omen for the York team.
And the man to watch on the York offense is William Austin. 32 catches for 343 yards this year. Had 11 receptions last week. And they're going to him on the first play and almost intercepted as Matt LaPointe got over to break it up. And it'll put York in a unenviable second and extra long situation, 15 yards to go for the first down.
Well, Bond, a.k.a. the Bully, as he is well known amongst his Ottawa U fans and to the local newspaper and media, Bond's one of those free safeties that you quietly love back there, Nate. We've seen it. He patrols that backfield something fierce, and, I mean, he's one of the players of the GGs. I don't want to say pleasant surprise because they were expecting it, but definitely one of these guys that has risen to the occasion.
There's a rollout pass by Nick Kachu, but he overshoots Alex Bugden, and it'll be a quick two and out by the York offense, and the GGs will look to get the ball in plus territory as Drawer David comes on to punt for the York Lions. So a good first defensive series by Ottawa.
Nick Kachu, a graduate of a well, the school down in St. Catharines that Wayne and I have some relations to, the Sir Winston Churchill Bulldogs, where a number of ex-GG football players have made their mark, most notably Steve Cook, Don Butler, and Greg Lake.
Isn't Steve Cook a head coach down there right now?
He just retired last year after 18 years of coaching.
Well, the GGs, as we foreshadowed, will take over at the York 47 after a short punt by David that was taken by the rookie receiver Ian Stewart.
Nate, you saw that there on that play, and I mean, it's one of the things I'm sure that's been plaguing the York squad all year. The execution, or if you were, the play was there, everything was in place, they just didn't execute. I mean, they had the open receiver. Interesting thing to watch, Nate, we'll watch when they get the ball back. It's one of the things you haven't seen in CIS in ages. They're running with a tight end, York, right now.
Yeah, Colvin will hand off to Gillanders on first down, and he'll push the pile ahead for four. As Ottawa just sort of tries to sniff out what York's defense is going to bring.
And I think it's important this week that they kind of establish that they're more than a one-trick pony. I think that a lot of the teams in the CIS right now are realizing we shut down Gillanders, and we're pretty much shutting down that Ottawa U offense. So I think Ottawa's going to pay some attention to that this week.
I think it's an opportunity for the GGs to really focus on their attack, passing attack today.
Yeah, Aaron Colvin had 312 yards last week, but maybe it was of the empty calorie variety because a lot of it came after the game was well in hand. Colvin airing it out on first down, going deep, and overshoots his receiver. Ottawa testing the York secondary early, but just come up empty.
It's one of those things where we saw it and we talked about it. And, I mean, we were talking about in the Toronto and the Queens, Nate. I mean, with Aaron, there's the transition. And we always talk about the physicality of the last two quarterbacks. I mean, there's no program in the country, with the exception possibly of Western, that is at that length of consistency, of high-level consistency at the pivot position. And, I mean, so we tend to think of just the physical aspects, but there you saw it again. York dropped back into a zone. They basically the flats were open to the field side. First down was there. Colburn goes deep. Now they're punting. One of those things where I'm sure he's going to look at it and film and want that one back.
Falvo will angle for the sideline. Price will let it go. It bounces down to Devontae Hobbs, and he'll bring it out to about the York 14. So not quite the result the GGs had, but they'll still net about 30 on the exchange as the York offense comes out for its second series.
Well, again, I'm interested to see here, Nate. I'm curious. And, Tommy, you take a look at it, too. It's just something. I mean, Tommy, I think this is near and dear to your heart because you were a slot back, but you were more built like a tight end back in the day. And, I mean, I have not seen this in years, Nate. I love it. I'm actually – and see, now they've come out of it, so I'm a little disappointed with York.
I think you're going to see – I remember the late, great Hamilton Ticat head coach Ron Lancaster talked about that, the later stages of his coaching career, about a bit of a transition going back to the tight end formation on occasion here.
Yes. Sefton has the completion to the young wideout, Curtis Price. He'll bring it out to the 26, and that'll be enough for the first down of this game.
I think one of the things you'll see, and I think York has made a nice adjustment, is what teams are adjusting to here, Nate, is that front five, the offensive line for York, if we watch them, we get a chance, or you viewers that are getting a chance to look at this, if you see so far each pass, it's been slide protection, which means they're not, even though they're not moving the quarterback out, they're trying to keep those linemen a little mobile, as such kind of, taking away from the Ottawa speed.
York again sticks with that empty backfield look, and now they hand it off to George Daniel, the bowling ball-style runner at fullback, and the GGs quickly gobble him up.
Wayne, you mentioned today in the pregame warm-ups that there are a couple of second-string backups for the GGs are going to get an opportunity to showcase themselves today due to injury.
Well, they've been that way for a couple weeks now. I mean, Ottawa U is an injury bug that bites everybody midway through the year. Ottawa U, unfortunately, it's one of those things as a coach you want to avoid. You know you're going to get the injury bug. Ideally, it's going to be various positions, not all hammering one position like they did with the defensive backfields, as Ottawa probably puts out two of their non-starters.
Sevden going long and overshoots Price, who looked like he looked over the wrong shoulder. And that'll hasten a punting situation for the Lions, but at least they get out of the shadow of their own goalpost.
We got away with one there. Curtis Price, number four for the York Lions, was wide open. Perhaps that's one of the backup cornerbacks for the GGs today that was...
Well, a lot of it, like you said, Tommy, you brought up a very good point. And, I mean, that's the one thing. And, I mean, we talked about the physicalness. And, I mean, obviously there's a drop-off. Your starter's your starter for a reason. But there's also the mental aspect of it. And, I mean, a lot of it in the zone coverage or the different responsibilities. I mean, there were clearly last week against Laurier some blown assignments because these guys are two good athletes. The guys aren't going to get that wide open.
Low snap for David. He'll force Frank Nagundi ranging right. Nagundi will take it at the own 48 and just quickly bring it up to near midfield before he's shoved out of bounds by Nana Nakansa.
As many of our viewers are probably aware, Nate, October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month. And as such, you will see several of the GG players, as they've chosen today, to kind of do their breast cancer awareness campaign here for the University of Ottawa. You'll notice several of the players wearing pink. And a special shout-out goes to the Old All-Conference lineman, Phil David, who graduated last year. He kind of spearheaded this thing, and hopefully we'll get a chance to speak with Phil, if not at halftime, shortly into the second.
Excellent. A very worthy cause. Officially marked at the 54, Colbin. Straight drop on first down. Again looks over the middle and has a man wide open, but again cannot connect. This time it was Simone Lamarcon. And if he'd caught that, he would have been through the canal by now.
Absolutely. He could have taken that all the way down to campus from here. You know, this is the type of game where you don't want to see these types of mistakes. You want to get on your opponent, get on them early. Certainly, this is not the kind of opportunity you can miss when you're going against the likes of Laurier, Western, McMaster in this tough OUA conference.
I think we could fairly call that a blown coverage because Lamarcon ran down the seam with
there
no one near him.
There seems to be an opportunity there because in the previous series, that same play was wide open again.
Did you stay with the double tights on second down? Colbin now going deep left for Bogdan Ryak, and he makes a great catch, extends, and will take it down for a first down at the six-yard line.
Well, a lot of what's happening here, Nate, is I don't even know if I'd go as far as saying it's a blowing coverage in as much as I'm watching the York DBs, and they're dropping back into their zones, but they're just, I guess by definition it is blown because they're dropping back, and they're just not, whoever's got the deep thirds isn't getting there. And you saw that was a zone where they picked up the corner route. But again, if I'm the DB coach for York, if I'm the DC, I'm wondering, where's your depth, son? Like, they got to get back there. If you're going to play a zone and you got deep thirds, and exactly what happened on the last play, the safety didn't get over. It became a one-on-one or a two-on-one matchup down the seam.
Here's the handoff to Gillanders, and he'll get forward for 2 yards before he's brought down by Hussein Hazimi.
Just a heck of a play previously by Bogdan Rajic, one of the veteran leaders of this offense here, fourth-year kid. Just a fantastic concentration on that play. Went right after that football.
And you brought up a good point, Tommy. He's kind of been forced into that leadership role with the injury to Steven Hughes at the beginning of the season. I mean, Bogdan was one of those guys that was kind of looked at the Alvin Harper of this team, if we're going back to the old Cowboys, and he's all of a sudden stepped into that premier role and done so well.
Colbin now will throw the long slant and misses Ian Stewart, and that will bring up a field goal situation for the GGs. So first and goal from the six, not able to get it in, but you like the fact that they were able to finally connect on one of those deep balls and get themselves in position for some points.
And another thing I do like, Nate, is if I'm the coaching staff, I come away there feeling good because, I mean, credit where credit is due. Colbin put that ball, and I'll get back to you. It looks like they're going to go for it here, Nate.
Oh,
okay. We'll touch on that in a second here.
We like that. We like the smart, aggressive coaching. I'm so focused on your point, Wayne, I didn't even know if the offense is still on the field. York showing blitz here. Colbin empties the backfield. The flag is down as Colbin throws deep, and he misses his man, but we'll see if this is a free play potentially. The GG sure hope so. Otherwise, it's a turnover on downs.
It appears as though the coaching staff of the Ottawa GGs feels that they can exploit that York secondary.
And indeed, it is offside York, so that'll move the ball to the two. And I guess it goes without saying that the offense will stay out. I mean, if they're willing to gamble from the four, they're definitely willing to gamble from half that distance.
Well, it looks like they are. They're going to send in some placements here, but definitely not the field goal team. The point I was just thinking about Aaron was, that's the thing you're looking from your quarterback. When he went for it on second down there, when they threw it out there, he put it where either the receiver gets it or nobody else gets it. And that's the type of thing we're looking for from him.
Actually, it's an automatic first down. Correct myself there. So the GGs will get 3 shots at it, at least. Double tight ends here. Colbin's again going to pass, throws the quick out, and Ryak drops the would-be touchdown pass. Had him open, but it was a short bullet pass, and Tom, as any receiver knows, those runs can often be hard to catch.
They can, but I guarantee you one that Bogdan would like to have again because he's a very sure-handed receiver, and not too often we're going to see him drop a ball like that.
There's never an excuse for it, but I'm saying it is tough.
No. He'll be doing push-ups at home after for this one.
So the GGs, curiously, now they load up with the I formation. Gillander's behind Alex Morrison. Again, some early movement. A flag is down. Gillander's picks his way through, and he's in for the GG TD, pending the penalty flag.
Might be coming back. No.
And no, it's offside, and obviously it's declined, so the GGs will break on top here at 7:05 of the first quarter on a 2-yard touchdown run by Brendan Gillanders.
Certainly the biggest offensive leader on this football team is Gillanders, and if we're going to go anywhere in the OUA playoffs, he'll certainly going to be a big factor, a big part of that.
Definitely, Tom, definitely. I think that, like I said, what they do have to do is kind of establish something outside of that, because teams are kicking in right now and starting to say, hey, if we can shut this guy down, we can shut it all down.
And you really like the way the patience of Brendan Gillanders showed on that touchdown run. I mean, the York had defenders at the point of attack, and he was just able to sort of knife through. Officially, the drive goes 6 plays, 55 yards. Of course, 49 of it came on that pass to Bogdan Ryak. So 7:55 to go in the first quarter, and the GGs break on top 7-0.
You hit it on the head, Nate. You made up a really good point. Tommy, you probably noticed this too. What's happening is Ottawa runs, they run what's known as the rail when they're going on their outside zone rush.
Certainly.
I mean, their outside zone, they stretch it out, and it's up to the running back. You need that talented, well, every team wants that talented running back, and Gillanders is definitely that. But more importantly, in the Ottawa U offense, what you need is you need that back, because they're going to run two types of scheme, either their inside zone or the outside, more of a stretch play. And on the stretch play, it's not a cutback play in as much as it's a lane cut play. And what Gillanders does so well on this, Nate, is that you'll see he picks his spots. And once he picks his spot, he goes. And that's what you need. You need that decisiveness, and that's what he brings to the table. And, I mean, he's probably one of the more talented backs out there. But even more importantly, he's one of the smarter ones in understanding the confines of the Ottawa U system and what he has to do to be successful within it.
Yeah, certainly. Foul ball to kick off here. The GGs again look to pin the Lions deep. York hasn't started from beyond its own 25 yet. Price on the return picks a spot and will break out to about the 26 before he's wrestled to the turf.
Very interesting return scheme we saw there. They kind of ran the wedge, but where you're generally saying, okay, wedge, we're going to wedge at the closest point of attack here. They actually put it where they were wedging as if they had an outside return on. Really interesting. And they set it up well. We'll take a look at it. I mean, clearly right now what I'm seeing, Nate, is I'm seeing a well-coached team that has parts. The plays are there, and that's got to be somewhat alarming to Ottawa U right now, because execution, not quite, but, I mean, the plays that they're calling right now are there.
Sevden will give the handoff to Daniel. He's met at the line of scrimmage by a host of GGs. Some excellent penetration up front.
Defensive line was absolutely swarming on that play. And again, going back to what we talked about earlier, really expect a dominant performance on both sides of the ball, especially from the University of Ottawa defense, probably one of the tougher defenses in the country.
Yeah, it looked like Kevin Carmichael got the early, one of the first hits in there and was able to disrupt that play. So second down and 10 after no gain by George Daniel. We're sticking with that 4 wide and 1 tight end look. Well, if you go to the wide side, complete to Curtis Price, his second catch. Can he get to the sticks? Looks like he will before being brought down by Ty Rusnak. Nice job of turning up field by Curtis Price.
Curtis is going to have a busy day today returning kicks and playing wide receiver as well.
It's actually funny, Nate. We alluded to this in the Toronto game, and this is one where I can take it. I don't mind the stretching out if it's sort of the first down. What I wasn't getting too much against Toronto there was when the receiver stretches out the ball to get that X to make it 4 yards as opposed to 3. So good job all around.
First and 10 for the Lions from the 37. This time it's Kachu at quarterback, and he'll keep it. Kachu looking to run back, make a little bit of a spin move, and will have close to first down yardage before being brought down by Francois Rodriguez.
Interesting how the York University offense is using a rotating quarterback system today, Snake.
Yeah, they talked about, I guess when I was talking to Michael Falds this week, they were saying it would almost be 50-50 with how they split the snaps.
Interesting.
Well, you know what? They seem to be onto something there, and I mean, whatever you can do to win the games. I mean, I'm liking the offense, and I'm liking the schemes they have in place. I mean, like I said, somewhat unsettling for the GGs are the plays are there. It's a matter of whether York executes or not.
Kachu stays in on this second and short. We'll see if he runs it again, and indeed he does take it on the draw. Is flushed to the outside and will be brought down 2 yards shy of the first down. Looked like Trevor Seal was up there.
Clearly that was a designed run play for the quarterback right from the get-go.
Do you go for it here, Tommy, Nate? Do you go for it?
I think when you're York University Lions, and, well, I guess that's why I'm not the head coach, because here they are bringing out the punt team. But when you're winless and you're on the road in a situation like this. I think you almost have to, but we'll see what they got here.
I like that point, but I'll ask you this. I'll play devil's advocate because that is conventional wisdom, and I agree with you, and that was my first thought too. It's like you're on the road, you're having your own. But then you got to think, there's a reason why we're 0-1 whatever, and maybe we best punt this away. So
flip side of that, what do you have to lose?
Exactly.
Nagundi back deep. Short kick taken, and it will be brought out to the 47. So, again, good field position for Ottawa after York had a semi-promising drive stall on them.
Well, this is going to get another shot to take a look at this Ottawa U offense. And, I mean, clearly the plays are there. The play calls are there. We'll see about the execution here. And it'll be interesting to see what Ottawa does coming back out. I'm sure that Ottawa U right now, and it's like we've said in the past, their objective right now is clearly to execute, put the underdog away quickly, and then work on what needs to be worked on to be successful at the second half of their OUA season.
GGs go back to Gillanders on the run up the middle, and he's dragged down by Hazimi and a host of Lions tacklers after a gain of about 5 yards.
Well, one of the things that you'd mentioned, Nate, and it's true with Brendan, is what he also brings to the table is he brings kind of that multi-purpose back. He's the one that we've seen him catch it out of the backfield, but more importantly, he can pound it up the middle. He can go through the sea. He can be both a slasher and a dancer when need be. Very smart, all-around talented athlete.
GGs also have Nagundi on the game on second down, lined up as a bit of a slot back, almost Andre Dury style. Hand off again to Gillanders. Cannot get to the first down. A flag is down. Might be a holding flag. Tackle made by the veteran defensive end, Stephen Redding.
Interesting coverage scheme there. It looks like the York Lions were going into kind of a flat top type coverage for pressure. And you know what? Like we said, I mean, he is a fourth-year guy on paper, but on the field he hasn't really played all that much. So, I mean, that's one of the things you're going to try to do is I think every team's going to do it, is they're going to try to show different fronts to Colbin. They're going to show different looks. And, I mean, obviously, when it comes down to just your pure athletes, I mean, I love the term that Barry Switzer used once when he talked about his days at Oklahoma. He said, I didn't out-coach anybody. I just out-athleted them. And, I mean, that's, you know what I mean, a valid concept. And I think in this case, York knows we're not going to out-athlete them. And that's not a slight at York. That's the reality of this afternoon's game. But that's the beauty of football, is it's the great equalizer is schemes.
And second punt of the day for Falvo. Price and Jordan Nugent are back deep. Nugent will take it at his own 16, looks for a middle return. Makes a nice little cut. A flag is down, and that's probably going to back the Lions up.
Pretty sloppy game so far. A lot of dirty laundry on the field today, Nate.
Yeah. They're thinking about the turkey, Tom.
I
had some hockey players use that one on me last night. Peterborough Petes were here and lost to the 67s 5-1, and they were like, well, it was our last game for Thanksgiving. All the young kids were thinking about going home. But, you know, that's where that you got to have that mental toughness, right?
Absolutely. You got to stay focused for 4 full quarters.
No, that's it. And I guarantee you that turkey will taste a heck of a lot better on Sunday for York if they're on a 5-hour road trip home.
So officially, after the illegal block penalty, York backed up to its own 10. Kachu will open at quarterback. York sticks with that one back look. Kachu on the inside, play action, has a completion, caught on the sideline for a short gain by William Austin, his first catch of the afternoon. It's a gain of 5. That was one of the more acrobatic 5-yard catches you're going to see. I mean, he had to go up for it, and then he had to straddle the sideline.
Well, if they have any success on offense, they're taking a look at his left side there, and for whatever reason, they're finding a little bit of success here.
Yep. Well, Austin, again, they always put him into the boundary, and he's lined up. Randy Williams is giving him a huge cushion over there on that corner. Kachu now looks to the right, airing it out deep, has Alec Bugden behind coverage and has a completion, but the ball is stripped, and the GGs will take over on the fumble recovery as it's being returned down the sideline by Matt Bond, marked down at the York 23.
If you had a big play like that, I guarantee the GG coaching staff will not be all that happy because they certainly got away with one there. If that ball's a little bit more thrown on step with the receiver, he's gone in the end zone. He's on Bank Street for a touchdown.
Not just that, but, I mean, you have to protect that ball better. I mean, that's – and, again, we've talked about it. We talked about it last week or 2 weeks ago at home with Toronto. We've talked about it going forward. I mean, if York's going to be successful, they have to hold on to those, Nate. That was just, I mean, that they got the point. Ottawa, you had a blowing coverage there. I mean, they ran the wheel off of that. Nobody picked it up. So they obviously got what they wanted, got the matchup, had the guy open. And I agree with you, Tommy. He throws it 2 yards ahead of him, and he's on Bank Street. But, I mean, they got to hold on to that.
Colbin on the play action, being pressured by Redding, and throws it sort of in between his short and intermediate receivers, and it's an incompletion.
No, I certainly agree with you that one, Wayne. But at the same time, I guess my point is that certainly you cannot have that type of coverage against, again, earlier, as I mentioned, but the teams like Western and Laurier, because they will exploit that to its fullest.
Oh, we saw it last week. We definitely saw it last week.
And I believe it was Chris Daly who got credit for the forced fumble, and Bond, of course, picked it up. And so York went from having a potential 95-yard touchdown pass with the ball had been thrown on target to Ottawa taking over in plus territory again. Second and 10 for the GGs. They stay with the double tights. Colbin now looking out to the right. Has Lamar Cohn with a big cushion. He'll be able to run to the sticks. Runs through a tackler and will have a first down at the 5.
I don't even know if I want to call that a good read. I mean, I'm not quite sure what York's doing on that. I don't know if they're trying to resemble. I don't think they are, and I'm going to keep an eye on this, Nate. I don't know if they're trying to drop back into type of a match coverage and keep everything ahead of you. But I mean, that was bad. I mean, Lamar Cohn, as talented as he is, I mean, a 5 yard out, you should not be sitting there. Like, there's no coverage schemes other than playing man and having a guy fall down, which didn't happen there, that allow for that. So I mean, York's got their defense needs to really kind of batten down the hatches right now and figure out what they're doing.
Colbin again drops back on first down, throws the deep corner out. Flag is down for Ryuk, and he'll have it for a GG TD. Check the flag.
I'm thinking offside against York, as that seems to be the normal MO for this York defense right now. But it looks like this one may be coming back on the slot it on the receiver.
Offside on the receiver. One of those perils of Canadian football with the unlimited motion. Put the GGs back to the 10. So it wipes out the touchdown. Catch for Ryan.
Rarely do you see that flag at the professional level. Again, I mentioned Ron Lancaster earlier. He had a great line one time about the former Saskatchewan Rough Rider, great slot back Ray Elgard. One time I guess his famous quote about him was that he was offside for 10 years.
Great ones know how to get away with it.
Certainly do.
So first and goal back at the 10. Colbin now play action, rolling left, has a huge corner to turn, will keep it, and will run for the end zone, and he'll be knocked down at the 1 yard line. Hazimi got over to save the touchdown, at least for now.
Nice effort by our quarterback. Nice to see him put his head down and try and get there.
Yeah, Aaron Colbin showed off his legs a couple times last week. I mean, it wasn't part of the game plan, but he ended up having a couple long scrambles against the Laurier Golden Hawks. I don't think that was by design there. That was just there's nothing there. Tuck it away and go.
No, definitely. That's the look you want to get out of your quarterback. I mean, he's by no means a Sinopoli, but is a good athlete who can take it to the house if need be.
Colbin here, hand off to Gillanders, and he'll go in, standing up, in for a GG TD, 13-0.
All around well executed there. It's what we alluded to, Nate. I mean, they're going with that outside zone. I mean, whatever you want to call it, the stretch play of the outside zone, whatever you want to call it. Gillanders goes, the line shuffles down, gets the rail set up. And, I mean, on that one, it was a little too easy. And, I mean, myself, I could have probably read that hole properly. But beautiful job still by Gillanders to see the hole open, see the crease, take it. And, I mean, even if that's from maybe 30 yards out, I think Brendan goes in.
He could have drove the team bus for that hole, Snake.
Sixth touchdown of the year for Brendan Gillanders. I think 5 of them have been on the ground. Volvo adds the point after to make it 14-0. By the way, I wanted to ask, because Tom, Wayne, you guys both played in the OQIFC era for the GGs. York uniforms remind you of McGill a lot?
Too much so.
Not in a good way, eh?
I was down on the field. It's funny because I said, you know what? They're not winning, but what they ought to do is just strip the logo, strip the lines, and just put the numbers on the side, because when you get down there,
Alabama.
It looked like Alabama. At least, you know, they'd have some trend or something to follow. Speaking of which, McGill... it should be an interesting game as rivalry week still continues, and we got McGill Concordia in the Quebec League tonight, which should be an interesting battle.
Is that the annual Shrine Game down there in Montreal?
It is, and I mean McGill goes in there winless, and McGill's a team that absolutely pounded Ottawa in the preseason. Now, granted, it's been Ottawa's MO for the last half decade. We know who our starters are when we go in there. You're getting one or two. They run it like an NFL team, so I mean you can't read too much in. But McGill is a strong game; should be interesting to watch.
Favreau to kick off for the third time. Taken by Price, who's been busy so far, attempting that return to the right. Fights off one tackle. and it's finally brought down at around the 22-yard line.
As you mentioned a little bit earlier, Wayne, about the rivalry week continuing here, I think a lot of football fans in the city are very excited to see Carlton get their football program back in 2013, which will hopefully renew the traditional Panda game.
Definitely, Tommy. Nate and I had talked about it last week, and Tommy, yourself having been involved, and well, yourself being from the city, having played in five games, much like myself, probably attended one or two of the games in high school, if not all of them. I mean, it's a big deal, and I mean, time really passes by. You don't realize how what a length of time has gone. And Nate, I'll let you grab this play, and then I'm going to elaborate just on a little story on the Panda.
Lions stick with Kachu at quarterback. Play action pass. It's short and caught by Jesse Merton. Actually, did they give him the catch? Are they giving it to him?
I give it to him.
I believe they are.
Give it to him.
They will. It'll be officially a gain of three, Wayne.
So, well, what I was saying, it's actually funny because, Nate, we talked numerous times, I'm involved in coaching at the Sage app and some of the midgets. Some of my players that are getting recruited and are thinking of going to Carlton, and I mean, it's a foreign concept. You have to be kids in their late teens that they have no idea about what this Panda game is, and the idea of having between 15 and 20,000 people out to watch a college game in Ottawa is completely foreign to most people.
Well, it was certainly one of the great sporting traditions in the city, if not the country. For years, it was the most attended CIS football game on the annual basis. But as you mentioned earlier, some great tradition, great history. Really looking forward to seeing that game back in town. And hopefully we can fill this place up again once it gets renovated.
Certainly. Obviously, you know, didn't grow up here, so never got to see one. Only heard about it because my mom went to Carlton.
Absolutely legendary.
One thing I would love to see, Tommy, is I don't even want to see the renovations done because it was a zoo when you separated the two sides. Could you imagine if they just put an imaginary barrier here on the north side?
It'd be like an Italian Serie A soccer game.
Exactly,
to put a fence down the middle.
Celtic
Ranger game.
Officially, it was an incompletion, and it was Arnaldo Lavris, the young defensive lineman for the GGs, shaken up. Long out to the sideline, and the pass is dropped by Mark Robinson Weeks, who's playing his first game of the season for York. So, again, a two and out by the Lions.
I think the G's are going to look to take advantage of this here and try and put this game away early. With 23 seconds to go in the first quarter, they can turn this drive around, get downfield real quick here, get a 21-0 lead.
Yeah. And we haven't seen much of Wendell this year, Nate, and I think that's an important thing because, I mean, he's one snap away from leading this team in the playoffs. So, I mean, I'm sure they'd like to get a better look at him this week.
Yeah. McGundy takes the punt at his own 52. Start goes straight up the middle and will return to be marked down at about the 46. And it would be nice to get Derek Wendell some first half snaps, you would think, right? I mean, not just mop-up time where the intensity isn't the same and you're facing the other team's backups, but actually maybe throw him in against the first string unit of the opposition.
Well, we said it last home game. We were actually quite surprised that it took them that long to get him into the game type of thing. Like, I mean, it was a bit of a surprising thing. But again, there's a reason why we're up here talking about it, and the real decision makers are down there. So,
last play of the first quarter here.
Indeed, it is, and Colbin on the play action will try that deep right down the seam again. And Laszlo Markov, first down inside the five.
Once again, the GG offensive coaching staff looking to take advantage of that weak York secondary, and doesn't get any easier than that.
I mean, the bottom line is, I mean, this is getting absolutely like. They're playing a base, like I didn't get on that one there, they're playing a base cover three. They're playing a cover three. And, I mean, the GGs are going up the seams. Rule of thumb is, I mean, the seams will be there, but they're there for such a short period. They're just not closing, nor are they recognizing anything here. I mean, York really, like, I mean, I've been impressed with the York, I guess I could say play calling or the game plan York's presented. I mean, it's up to the athletes to execute it. And granted, there's a difference between the two teams, but, it's just... The coaches need a little help here. I mean, York's got to start to crack down. They got to see that seam. They got to recognize it. That's the weakness in the defense. You got to be looking for that.
You know, as I mentioned earlier at the start of the game, Wayne, this is the type of performance we expected to see dominant-wise from both sides of the football. And, you know, the GGs still have a couple of tough games ahead of them before the regular season ends because Windsor now is a resurgent football program. Also having to play Mac, who's one of the tougher teams in the conference. So hopefully this does bode well for the GG's confidence moving forward the next couple of weeks.
Oh, I think you're 100% right, Tommy. I think Windsor's a pleasant surprise in relay level. And, I mean, McMaster is going to have Quinlan back in uniform for them. I believe Quinlan's first game back is this weekend, Nate.
Oh, he played on Thursday.
Oh, did he play on Thursday?
Mac always does the Thursday thing on Thanksgiving weekend. He didn't have a very good game. He only threw for 455 yards.
He probably had a lot on his mind.
He was thinking turkey too, Nate.
Yeah, only 455. Disappointing. I'm just joking. York shifting just before the snap. Colburn's going to pass again and has it complete for a touchdown.
I believe that'll be against York. Looks like they jumped early here.
Yeah, look, Simone Lamarcon will get credit for the touchdown if it stands, which we believe it will.
Simone taking advantage of the opportunity today to showcase himself, having a hell of a ball game so far.
Griffon de Outaouais graduate Simone Lamarcon, as the Griffins are frequently referred to as the GG's farm team, and we'll see it. It seems to be growing each year. Nate, interesting point you brought up, and I'll ask you and Tommy this. Would you consider bringing in Derek right now at QB? I mean, you have the 21-point lead. You're the better team. It's a risk, but it's one of those things. I think you got to get him some time. And I like what you said, Nate. Not mop-up duty, not 42-0.
You know, I think it's a little bit early in the ball game right now. It's just the second quarter is just beginning. I think, as I mentioned earlier, you want your first unit to build up a tremendous amount of confidence going in for the next couple of weeks. But I certainly agree with being able to get him some few snaps with the first unit.
Oh, no, I leave
the end
first
of the second
unit
quarter,
in.
But at the start of the second half as well.
I leave the first unit in. Don't get me wrong.
Yes.
But, I mean, I got to present this as it is. I'm not going to make any, like, I'm not going to make this into a fantasy world.
No.
I mean, basically what you have is you have the OUA, then you have Waterloo, York. Unfortunately, these are two programs that are on downsides. I mean, obviously, Waterloo has reasons to be. And York has been struggling. And as such, I think Ottawa, you could probably play their third stringer QB and continue with
Certainly.
The integrity of what they're doing here. So, I mean, I think it's crucial for the big picture. I understand what you're saying, Tommy, about getting the momentum and whatnot. But I also believe that, you know, they're one snap away from having an untested guy come in at QB.
The only thing I will say to that is if Aaron was in his third or fourth year of starting, I would completely agree. But Aaron, it's really, he's only played a handful of games as a starting quarterback for the GGs right now. So, you know, he's still finding his way. He's still finding his groove. He's still learning to be the leader of this football team. So I think it's games like this where you really got to let him in there and perform and really command that leadership role. And I think that this is an opportunity, a game like this, for Aaron to really seize the reins of this offense.
Indeed. I think maybe if it gets to 28, then you think about it. But maybe that's something you have to talk about before the game. Low driving kickoff taken by Curtis Price at his own 7. Price will again try that left-to-right return, and great coverage by the GGs as
hits.
Nick LaCour got down to
big
level.
Hits. And that was Nagundi on that, and that was absolutely, that was Frank Nagundi on the play. And Frank, what he did there, Nate, I think you saw that, is, I mean, they came out, and on that, they had the wedge set up, and we've all heard the term wedge buster. I mean, I guarantee you, you go give it about a half an hour with today's media. You go on Wikipedia, you'll find Wedgebuster, you'll find a picture of Nagundi. That was absolutely phenomenal what he just did there.
He
went down and he took out three guys in the wedge, and that was it.
And
that was going nowhere.
LaCour had a pretty easy route to the ball carrier. I believe it's Price that's shaken up.
Earlier you said if it gets to 28, I think it's just a matter of time of when it gets to 28, Nate.
Yeah. 14:35 to go before half, and Ottawa up 21-0. And you were mentioning, of course, the GGs do have like some tough games coming up with the Windsor Lancers in here next Saturday, which we'll have on Streaming Sports Network Canada, of course. And then, of course, that trip down to Hamilton on the October 22nd.
That'll be a tough ball game as well going to Hamilton.
Yeah, the McMacs, they're pretty focused now after going through 3 weeks without their starting QB.
They're starting to come into their own as well, so that will be a very, very tough ball game. Neither game is a sure thing for this GG football program.
Oh, I definitely think that the Windsor game is, like you said, is not a sure thing. I'd go as far as I would think at this point in the season right now, Ottawa's got to be the underdog going into Mac.
Absolutely.
Going down to Hamilton, Mac's like Nate, you just said, they're hitting their stride. I think this is the next couple weeks are really going to tell a lot.
They're
loaded
on offense. They got a lot of game breakers on that football team.
Colburn now. Again, that long out has a completion, and it will be a touchdown for Ottawa. Yeah. Oh, they're actually going to mark him at the 1. I thought he was over.
He was clearly over. If we had instant replay, I think that play would be getting overturned. Well, at the 5-yard line. They're going in for the convert here, Nate.
All right. You put one over on me.
That turkey can do crazy things to a person.
Yeah, it's the tryptophan.
I was about to say, when you start getting visions of tryptophan, boys, then
I saw the touchdown signal, then heard the PA announcer say, "Own at the 1," but they clearly misread it. Falvo adds the extra point, and again, indeed, it's 28-0. So now it's time to change QBs.
Nate, how many times have we learned not to listen to the stadium announcer?
Nice to see Colbon spread the ball around a little bit and get the ball into a lot of people's different hands today.
Yeah.
It is. The problem with this game, too, is, and that's the other thing, and I know I sound like a broken record, but it's also one of those games, and I mean, the CIS level, there's a certain degree of discipline. I mean, you just don't want to get anybody hurt right now. I'm not trying to beat up on anybody, and I'm not trying to bash the opposition or opponent. But, I mean, clearly there's a huge, huge discrepancy in talent levels, if you will, between the two teams. And, I mean, York's in, I don't want to say a perpetual building program, but it's been a few
certainly
years.
It seems that way, and you really feel for that program. And, you know, one thing you take a look at, too, they've actually produced, several tremendous ball players that have gone on to very successful pro careers. You take a look on the Argos alone, you got Jeff Johnson, who's had a great CFL career, Andre Dury, who's arguably as talented as any running back ever to play Canadian football, and Ricky Foley, who ended up at one point trying out for the New York Jets in the NFL.
And let's not forget Sean Foudy.
Short kickoff taken by Janelle Tolbert, who's filling in for the injured Price.
Sean Foudy's a heck of a player.
And Tolbert will break it out to the 36, where York will have their best starting field position. I'm still flummoxed by that whole was he in, was he out thing down on the corner of the end zone.
Well, it's been a bit of a mystery down in Southern Ontario as to why this is taking so long for this program to turn itself around. They've had a number of coaches go in and out of that door there. They've got some great facilities. They've got an athletic director who supports the football program. You'd really love to see this team get a few wins and start to turn it around.
Dimitar Sevdin back in at quarterback after Kachu had handled the last couple series. Ottawa trying some press coverage on the outside against William Austin. Kachu will look over the middle, and there's a flag down. Could be a penalty against the GG secondary.
And I'm wondering, Nate, who was the intended receiver? I'm thinking maybe it was PI on a receiver that it wasn't intended to, but all's well that ends well, I guess, for York at this point.
Yeah, the pass went to the over receiver, and the interference might have been on the under receiver.
Regardless, it's going to go against the GGs.
Legal contact penalty, I believe, so automatic 10 yards and a first down for York out at the 46. First
down. Empty backfield from York here, Nate. Kind of interesting. We've seen multiple looks at that from there. They looked offside there. They don't get the call.
And again, a little miscommunication.
I'm wondering if we'll see that empty backfield again, Nate.
Yeah. You know what? I think we're going to see a lot of it today because that GGD line is completely controlling the line of scrimmage. And what little success this York University offense has had, it's been through the air, so I think we're going to see a lot more of that.
Well, I definitely like the slide, and like we said in the first couple series there, the plays were there. I mean, Nate, you hit it. It's probably the most acrobatic 5-yard catch you've ever seen, but if that's put on the numbers, maybe he gets another 3-4 yards because he was open, because they're getting the plays where they need to be.
And of course they had the long completion to Bugden that was nullified when he fumbled. Pressure coming on Sevdin, and he throws it up for grabs, a flag down in the secondary.
Not sure what that's going to be for.
Yeah, it looked sort of random. It almost looked like the GG defensive backs had a better shot at the ball than Alex Bugden did.
Certainly an uncatchable ball. Interesting to see what the call is going to be here. Okay.
So holding in an automatic first down again.
Not something the defensive coordinator for the University of Ottawa, GGs, is going to be pleased to see. Number of flags going in the secondary here today, and I guess a team like this is not the type of play you want to see from your secondary, regardless if it's a couple of second stringers filling in for some lost starters due to injury.
Flag down again, and Sefton has Hobbs in stride for a first down.
Beautiful
at
read.
The 32.
Great read.
31 officially.
And there are definitely a breakdown in coverage, as I believe it's Sawyer went out, but too late to pick that up, and you saw him. He just said basically what we were looking at there. That was Devontae Hobbs there, Nate, and we saw him kind of go. He was uncovered, and I was sitting there wondering, is he going to see it? Is he going to see it? And boom. So, I mean, York showing some signs of life here, Nate.
Yeah, that may be the York's longest play of the day, 23 yards on the gain. Nice grab by Devontae Hobbs. Although, again, showing some different looks up front. Sevdin, again, throws the quick hitter, but overshoots Janelle Tolbert, and it's incomplete.
And I think, you know what, again, that's there. the play was there, the slant route was there, and I mean they're just the QBs for York aren't necessarily getting the ball there when they needed to. So
I think they basically abandoned the ground game here today, and why not when you're winless and your ground game's not gonna be able to move the ball. It's a beautiful day, sunny, no wind. Put it in the air.
Yeah, this was a day made for passing.
Absolutely.
Sedvin will look to pick up this 2nd and 10 at the GG 31, deepest penetration of the day for the Lions. Sevden looking out to the right, has it for a first down, and the ball comes out. I believe that's going to be ruled an incompletion. Jesse Merton wasn't able to tuck it away before it was stripped out.
Certainly one Merton has to catch in a ball game like this.
And nice job by Cody Payne in coverage.
That was a great ball.
Payne definitely got his hand in there, did a nice job after being beat, but a good ball, and I mean, it just looked awkward. Tommy, you played the position, so you tell me, but that just looked really awkward the way he looked like he was almost fighting it. And again, I mean, I got to call it what it is. It's just, this is a rebuilding team, and I mean, we saw it in the pregame warm-up, and we'll see. Hopefully they can build on this, and I mean, they're probably a few athletes short here or there to kind of take it to the next level or kind of get in that mid-pack zone for the OUA.
Officially a 38-yard try for rookie kicker Henry Dervishi, and it's short. Soonbaum Cha will return it out and has a lane, and Soonbaum Cha is off and running. Dervishi gets contact on him, but Cha is still out at the 40. He's trying to angle away towards the sideline, still going down the side, and looks like he's running out of gas, and he'll finally almost let himself be dragged down at the York 37. And that's going to go for about, if I can trust my Ontario High School math, about a 75-yard return.
Well, we've seen that time and time again because it's certainly not like a punt return or a kick return. Anytime there's a missed field goal, there is an opportunity for a game breaker to happen. And Soonbaum Cha, arguably my favorite name in CIS football,
we'll give him the 36.
Took advantage of the breakdown on the York University field goal team here. And as you said, he just looked like he appeared to run out of gas.
And indeed it was. York fortunate that their holder, Jordan Nugent, is one of their starting defensive backs, so he was sort of able to get a good angle of pursuit and wait for his teammates to catch up. So great field positioning in for the GGs. I think they've started more drives in York territory than in their own. Going deep for Lamar Kahn and in for a GG TD. But
a late flag
is down, and it looks like it might wipe this play out. Have we had a touchdown play that hasn't had a flag on it yet?
Doesn't appear to be.
Other than maybe the one Gillander's first short scamper.
Looks like it's coming back against the GGs. Unfortunately for Simon Lamarcon, who's having a hell of a ball game.
And Lamarcon, who actually got by, that was number 26, Cody Bellardine, the St. Peter's local product in his first year. Brother started at Mount Allison and actually currently is back home playing for his Ottawa Invaders. So we'll take a look at Cody. This is kind of a bit of a homecoming as they didn't come in last year.
And again, indeed, not just a hold, but an unnecessary roughness call. So that backs it up 15 yards all the way to the York 51, first and 25. York, looks like we're going to have another flag here. Might have been offside on York because they were looking. They had six guys in the box looking to blitz. A lot of flags in this first half.
Pretty sloppy ball game. And again, the GG coaching staff will not be pleased about this, and I believe they will be addressing this, to put it politely, at halftime in the locker room here.
Well, it's not uncharacteristic. Both teams are, I think, in the bottom five in CIS in penalty yardage. So and it's not atypical of either team to have a lot of orange flags on the field.
But that's something you want to see at this point of the season. Certainly maybe in week one, week two,
you might
be able
down.
To understand why it happened, but at this point of the season, this is not the type of discipline you expect to see from your ball club.
All right, so first down over again at first and 20 now. Colbin now turns back, throws, has a completion over the middle, and it goes off the hands, and it's picked off by Jordan Nugent.
I tell you.
And instead of the touchdown, Simo ends up getting that tipped off. And you know, Nate, you guys brought up a good point. I mean, it's probably been the bane, if you will, of Ottawa's existence. It at least has been a blemish on their success over the last six years. And is their discipline when it comes to the penalties, to the flags. They've had this problem in the for as long back as I can remember, it just seems they shoot themselves in the foot almost.
But that's a play that, I mean, you cannot drop that ball. That Eric Colburn had all day to throw. Makes a perfect strike to Simone, who's having a heck of a ball game.
Yeah.
And that's just all mental. I mean, we've already seen the type of athlete that Simone is. That's a catch that he's got to make in his sleep.
Is that an instance where he was looking to where he was going to run? Because there was a huge passing window right there in
that
York
zone. I
think
it's just a lack of focus, to be honest with you.
Quads to the right. They go back to Austin on the short side, and he drops it with Randy Williams breathing down his neck.
Great cover. Great read on that ball.
So, again, York, you know, they got what they wanted. They got to isolate Williams one-on-one, and he couldn't come up with it.
I think Randy was one step away from taking that to the house himself. That could have been a pick six there easily.
No, half a second later.
We haven't had a pick six yet on our broadcast yet, so we're hoping for one. Either team, not too
choosy. Almost last week, or 2 weeks ago, rather. Rusnik kind of bobbled it. If he doesn't bobble it, I think he brings it to the house.
Yeah. New York will try to pick up this 2nd and 10 from their own 32. Sevden looking right, long out, and just a bit of miscommunication there as Bugden got spun around.
Six there, Nate, and that's the type of play, the out to the wide side of the field where that ball just hung up there.
That's a heart-in-your-mouth type of throw.
It really is, and I mean, like I said to many a quarterback that I've worked with, I mean, you need to know yourself, and the coaches need to know too. I mean, you can't be throwing those balls unless you're either you see something that's blatantly there or you're confident that you can get it there without any type of issue or concern. Because, I mean, that's a heck of a hard throw to make, especially at this level and especially with the dimensions of the football field.
Gerard David on to punt again for the Lions.
I'm looking for a big return here in this play.
Ottawa definitely looking to set it up.
Nice kick.
Great kick, and it will chase Ian Stewart back. He'll spin around at his own 30. Picks his way up to the middle, and Hussein Hazemi will wrestle him down at around the 39. Hazemi's, if he hasn't made most of the tackles for York, he's been around the ball probably more than any other defensive player on York. They're starting middle linebacker.
First-year kid out of Senator O'Connor Secondary School in East York, Toronto area. Noel Krabs, former U of T quarterback, has really done a great job of rejuvenating that football program at Senator O'Connor in the... Really expect to see a number of kids come out of that school in the next couple of years.
And you'd think as the grassroots of football in the Toronto area, the high schools, the community city programs get better, that will eventually filter its way up to the university scene.
Yeah, you certainly hope so, especially with York here.
Officially for Ottawa, they take over on the 40. Frank Nagundi gets his first handoff, slices over left guard for a gain of about 5.
Nice to see Frank get some time here in the backfield. As you mentioned earlier, about possibly shutting it down so you don't see any injuries. I don't know if Gelanders will get many more ball carries today.
Yeah, and of course, I mean, there's always that. I mean, I'm being a Queens graduate, you can always think of that scenario of having your number one tailback hurt in a nothing game like Queens did with Mike Giffen 3 years ago.
Sure.
Hurts his knee and goes out for the season on the first play against Waterloo when they already had first place sewn up. And I think we know what happened in their next game. Pass is dropped.
Yes, I think another running back had an okay day that next week, I think.
I think Davey Mason did all right.
Yeah, I think he did okay.
And Craig Bears, had a big game too as well. Now the GG's running back coach. So a 2-and-out for York. I've always wanted to tell Craig Bears that day changed my life because I said I will never get mad over a sports event ever. So I was like listening to that game and I'm like, that's it. I'm not getting mad anymore. Whatever happens, happens.
Yeah, well, when Davey Mason, I mean, Lord knows, I got to watch him from his rookie season right through, and it was the O-Train was a lot of fun to watch.
He really was. Very reminiscent of the bus down in Pittsburgh, Jerome Bettis.
Price and Nugent back deep for the Lions. It'll be Price taking it in a slide down. It looks like it's going to be a no-yards penalty of the 15-yard denomination since he caught it in the air.
Of a line drive by Falvo, not something we see too often. I mean, Matt's, like you said, he's the do-all specialist for the GGs, and he's quite effective at doing it all, quite frankly.
Not his best kick, certainly.
Yeah. And it's a bit of a strange one. Well, since there's, like I say, no wind at all today, the flags on the goalposts are just standing there completely limp.
So it's an absolutely gorgeous day in the nation's capital here. The fall colors coming in.
Yeah.
Lining the Rideau Canal, just what a great place to play football and attend a game.
Especially compared to like last week, I was at Varsity Stadium in Toronto getting rained on. And now I got shorts and T-shirt weather here.
Never mind last week, Nate. I was coaching on Thursday night with gloves, a toque, and a winter jacket on as the temperature dropped to -1. But I'm not complaining right now. Trust me, my good man.
Okay, York will get their best starting field position at the 52. Kachu back in at quarterback. Kachu on the half roll to the left, going deep down the sideline for William Austin. Has to look back for the ball. Will they give it to him? No, he was out of bounds.
No, and that's karma because, I mean, quite frankly,
yeah, it looked like a bit of a
push off too. Exactly. I mean,
Michael Irvin would be proud. So it could have been York's biggest play of the day, but will not stand. Austin did, I think, an incredible job of turning around to locate that ball because I don't think it was thrown quite on time.
Was that Robert Payne or was that Austin there?
Austin 81. No.
Or excuse me, for the GM at the corner. I believe it was Robert Payne.
Yeah, it was Payne.
Yeah. It'll go a long way. Across the middle.
You're going to see a lot of different guys rotating through the GG secondary for the rest of the way. Dustin Wilson, a young kid out of St. Pat's, now getting some time at the wide side corner.
Good to see.
And down the sideline again, going for Austin and incomplete. Check that. That's Mark Robinson Weeks, actually, the receiver making a season debut for York.
Kotu demonstrating a bit of some pretty good arm strength here. I mean, again, obviously arm strength means nothing without the accuracy on it, but quite impressed. I mean, his technique is not the most impressive. Now, having said that, that could be a result of post-traumatic stress disorder in terms of if you get hammered enough, you're just going to inevitably start throwing off your back foot as a habit.
But Nick was a highly recruited player across Ontario and pretty much the entire country when he was coming out of Sir Winston and St. Catharines, and the folks at York were very lucky to land him.
Good high punt from David. Will chase Frank Nagundi back to his own 10-yard line. A flag is down. Nagundi's got a hole. Nagundi out across the 40 before he's finally brought down by Nathaniel Griffith. It's officially a 31-yard return, but I don't think it's going to hold up. I mean, Ian Stewart. I'm getting the zero is getting me confused.
No, we alluded on it, Nate. It's the new numbers they put on. They used to have the nice
we're having
player, the single.
They are a nightmare. And I've got the binoculars, and I'm still missing guys. Yeah, I think it was actually on that sideline play by York. It was actually Robinson Weeks was the receiver, not Austin.
But these numbers aren't the easiest to read, especially when you get into the 80s.
So I think this will put the GGs probably back at their own inside their own five. They're marking it at the 4 officially.
Which is probably why we're still seeing Colvin in the ball game here.
Yeah, we're down to 6:58 in the first half. Glad.
But see, this is where I disagree. This is exactly where you'd want to give Derek a shot. It's 28-0. York's not coming back.
There's some pressure. There'd be some pressure on him.
But again, his first year as a starting quarterback here, you want to see what he can do when he's in the shadows of his own goal line here.
Yeah, I disagree. I think you got to get your backup some time right now, and I think Nate just brought up an even stronger point, is the fact that there's such a drop. They don't know what they have. You can't risk an injury right now at any of your key points. And, I mean, in this, it's 6:30 to go in the half. Your defense is shutting them down. Let's call it what it is. Barring a miraculous effort and a series of miracles, York is not scoring 28 points and a half of football against Ottawa. It's just not happening.
I hear you. And I think we will see that start of the second half, if not sooner.
Yeah. I think we talked about it, Nate, and I'll let you get back to the game action here.
Gilders picked up 4 on first down with Patrick Russell making the tackle. Gilders gets it again on second down. Looks like he'll move the sticks as he's brought down by Michael Livingston.
Like, I understand you want to get it out of there. You don't want to give up the points. You want to give it. But even now, I like what both of you said earlier. I have Nagundi running out. If we can't, well, we can't. And as much as I like to see Derek get a little playing time, I think it's even more crucial to keep Brendan healthy here. Because, I mean, Galanders goes down, and I think the whole outlook of your season, not just the outlook, but the makeup of the GG's offense changes drastically.
Gilders again on that zone play, short gain before he's brought down by Patrick Russell. Give him three officially.
Another one by Gilders, another gain of 3.
Well, it should be interesting to see if and what adjustments both teams make. We're going down to the 5-minute mark here. And, I mean, again, it's one of those things. If you're Ottawa, you need to remain very focused on what you're trying to accomplish, but keep in mind what you have ahead of you, for lack of a better term.
Another short run, and the GGs will be in a punting situation.
So the GGs get out from out the shadows there.
I think
guys.
That was the only objective maybe of that series was just to move it out. Don't do anything that's going to give York life here, although the Lions will probably get the ball around to maybe their own 50 or so.
They should have great field position here to try and get one in before the half ends here.
No, and like you said, though, aesthetics are everything. And, I mean, yeah, obviously we want to try to, if you're Ottawa U, you want to try to help your defense procure a shutout here. So, I mean, they accomplish their goal, get it out to the 20, and hopefully Falvo can put a bit of his leg behind this one.
End-over-end kick by Falvo. That'll bounce down around the 50. Jordan Nugent finds a bit of a lane to the outside and will take it inside the GG 40 before Robert Griffith herds him into touch.
Best field position starting any drive here for York today inside GG territory. They get a couple first downs here. They could be threatening to get in the end zone.
Yeah, about a 20-yard run back by Griffiths to a GG 36. So, excuse me, by Nugent before Griffiths put him out of bounds.
Best field position of the day. Let's see if they can do anything with this.
Yeah. It's almost their deepest penetration of the day. They got down to the 31 once and missed. And Dravisky missed the field goal.
A little confusion here with the York offense.
Yeah, Kachu had to reroute William Austin before the play. Play action. Kachu has pressure. Will throw off his back foot, and Janelle Tolbert comes back to the football, bails his quarterback out.
Great play by Tolbert coming back to the ball here. That's exactly what you want to see from your wide receiver.
And decent poise by Kachu there, not to panic. And, I mean, like I said, when I talk about his mechanics being poor, I'm only half joking when I think that he's probably gotten so much pressure in his face. He's redeveloped his mechanics that throwing off his back foot is his most effective end. He's
They've
become
done
skilled
some good things with their passing attack. Obviously, the ground game is not going anywhere today, but with this York passing attack, it's they've done some decent things.
Second down and two. Sevden's back in, and he throws it behind William Austin. Now, if you're the Lions here, third and two, yeah, you got to keep the offense on the field. Give them a chance
without
here.
Without a doubt here, because, you know, we saw the leg strength of the kicker earlier in the game here, and so this is clearly would be a very tough task for him. But at this point, as you mentioned, winless on the road, 3 minutes to go in the half here. We're only 2 yards to go. You got to keep your offense out there.
It's interesting to see, and I'd like to know, and obviously we'd have to ask the coaching staff and ask Coach Falls and whatnot, but I'm curious as to if there's any real, what the reasoning is behind the rotating quarterbacks, and B, if there's any type of game plan, like, okay, are we doing two or three? Again, I mean, obviously we're not privy to their game planning sessions all week, and I mean, at this level, you know, that the coaches do come in with a game plan for that type of thing. But right now, Nate and Tommy, I'm not seeing anything. Are you guys picking up anything?
You know, the only thing I can compare this to is the Dallas Cowboys circa 1970 when Coach Landry was rotating both Craig Morton and Roger Staubach on every single play here.
I'm thinking more recent. I'm thinking late 90s, Noah Brindise and local Ottawa product Jesse Palmer for the Gators. Were Spurrier. And even that, though, I understood. Like, I mean, you basically had the intellect with Brindise brought to the physical talents that Jesse brought, the young rookie Jesse who was thrust into an unlikely position.
Yeah, and York indeed will try the 35-yard field goals. Henry Dervishi is
again,
on.
That's why we're up here and not down there.
They talked it over and decided, let's kick it. Dervishi driving kick, and it's good. So York's on the board at 28-3 now with 3:15 to go before the half. We're trying to scrounge up some out-of-town scores, one that's going to surprise you, Tom and Wayne. Right now, the Guelph Griffins, at last reporter, up 7-6 on the number 2 nationally ranked Western Mustangs. Western struggled last year with Guelph, and suddenly having their hands full again. They'll have to make some.
Now, is Donnie Marshall playing in that game?
I believe he's out right now.
Yeah, I think he's out from last week. Having said that, though, I think Western's developing a reputation they'd rather avoid as a team that needs the time to wake up. I mean, Ottawa U was over a 30-point loser to Western. Few would believe that 4 minutes into the third quarter, rather, that it was a tie 6-6. York had him last week. It should be interesting.
Well, you'll see that with Greg Marshall, coach teams sometimes. I'm not sure why it is, but they do make great halftime adjustments. Throw to the short side to Ryuk. He's wide open and takes the ball into York territory before he's wrestled out by Corey Bellerden. Mark it out at the 53, gain of 22.
And again,
that's a huge cushion York keeps giving.
I'm going to keep an eye on this, Nate, and I mean, we're going to watch this because I don't know if they're trying to play a semblance of match or what the deal is, or if somebody's just breaking out. If perhaps they're playing a version of cut, and maybe the both are dropping, the corners dropping, but it just looks right now like we saw it earlier where they brought six or seven men up, and then everybody else kind of sat back. Should be interesting to see what happens. And, I mean, quite frankly, this is too high a level of football to think you're going to get away with that.
Yeah, you think you'd like to see them be a little bit more aggressive here and impress a little bit more than what they are.
And again, you see those big cushions being given by both York corners. Colbin now on the half roll, gets it away. There's a flag down. Could be a roughing the passer call on Patrick Russell.
It's a hold against the...
hold, okay. I just saw him go flying and see the flag go, but...
I don't think he actually got a piece of Colbin there, but anyway.
Yeah, I just saw Colbin go and saw the guy on the ground, and you're watching the play in the other corner of your eye. The human head is at least, what, three eyes short of properly watching the armored pass? But now I'll leave it to the experts here. Ottawa did shuffle around the offensive line a little this week, too. Fred Castleman had been starting our last broadcast. He had a couple holds called on him, and he's... wasn't starting today. They've got Kevin McGee back in at left guard. They've moved some bodies around. I think Taylor Service is starting at his third different offensive line position this season. He's played both guard spots and tackle.
Well, it's definitely a testament to O-line coach Irv Damon, because coming in, this was a completely reworked O-line.
Colbin going deep. Has a command. And it's caught by Lamar Kahn, who probably moves past the 100-yard mark on that completion down to the York 25.
Easily over 100. And once again, just showing the type of athlete that he is. It's a heck of a... Then there was a great job. You know, we talked a little bit about earlier about him not really focusing or concentrating too much when he dropped that one ball in his hands. But, you know, I have to give credit where credit's due. And Simone right there just showed a great level of concentration and focus on that ball and really brought it in with a man all over him.
Yeah, and Jordan Nugent, who's been one of the bright spots for York with that interception earlier that ended a GG drive, is down injured and getting attention.
Look at 2:31 left to go. Quite frankly, Nate, I don't think this 28-3 score comes as any surprise. I mean, the way they've gotten there is no surprise. And I mean, I don't know about the two of you. Were you expecting anything else out of this team? Or
No. I took Ottawa minus 25 in the pool.
Yeah, probably a good move.
Although we did have one other big spread that did get covered, because St. FX only lost by 24 to St. Mary's. So.
Oh, what was the what did they have?
I can't remember. Our guy, he has some points for and against formula. He works it out. And I think he's at St. Mary's at minus 29 or something. The closest spread this week, because, well, no games in Canada West this week. The closest spread is the Windsor Queens one. So we're just doing it for fun. No money, unfortunately, but just sucks because I'm in first place. Unbelievably, for a guy who's, you know, mis-ID'd about three players in the first half. Nugent off, walking under his own power.
Nice to see that, because he's one of the better players with York. And, of course, you don't see anybody injured.
No, and a good credit goes. We didn't bring it up, but, I mean, quite frankly, I mean, if you're going to look at the positives here for York, I mean, their 3 points is much deserved. As much credit goes to the kicker as it does to young Jordan Nugent. No relationship to Ted, I don't think, but great
the
hands.
The famous hunter, Ted yeah. Nugent.
Colbin again, nice ball, down to complete to the sideline, caught by Ian Stewart, and he fights to stay in bounds. It looked like it'll be a goal-to-go situation for the GGs. Of course, we're asking about out-of-town scores. Guelph Western game, the only other game going on in the OUA this afternoon, because we had a couple Thursday nighters with the Thanksgiving, and then Windsor likes to play on Saturday night, I guess.
Yeah.
I guess they had figured, being so close to Michigan, you don't want to compete with the Wolverines and Spartans for crowds.
I don't think they do any night of the week. But, you know, it's nice to see them turn that program around, because for years that City of Windsor has produced some tremendous athletes, but they just had a hard time keeping them in town.
Yeah, Stewart got all the way down to the 4-yard line. GG's again use that split backfield. And Colbin has a lane, and he'll run it in for a GG TD. That's that play-action pass they love to run for Nagundi, but it wasn't there this time.
No, definitely. I mean, what you got there with Aaron is again, he's making the reads. I mean, it's one of those things that, I mean, as each week progresses, Nate, we're seeing it more and more. He's coming into his own, and he's making some good plays, some good reads, and we see it there. I mean, obviously, he sees the opening, takes it, brings it to the house, and, I mean, the result, the GG's looking to make it a 32-point lead here with the convert.
And, I mean, take the I guess, caliber of the defense into account, but anytime you can go 75 yards in a minute, 7 seconds, I think you'll take that.
No, you know. No, and that's it. And I think the key to this week, and we talked about it just before the kickoff, is, I mean, in a game like this, you have to take it for what it is. You can't. You have to look at, I guarantee you, that coaching staff is going to break down the film, and they're looking for perfection in execution. They're not looking at the scoreboard to be any type of indicator. I mean, you're expected to win. Like you said, we'll call it a 25-point favorite. They're expected to win. You're expected to be dominant, and you got to execute. And, I mean, again, it's one of those things. We saw it in Toronto. We saw it at Queens. And again, it's got to be somewhat worrisome for them because of the slow offensive starts. And it's not even that the plays aren't there. It's the lack of execution. We saw it again this week. You know, the 35-3 score doesn't reflect it, but it's still, it's one of those cautionary things where the GGs have to be a little bit concerned about that, knowing that, you know what, you're only going to get so many chances once you start getting to the meat of the OUA, or returning to it, if you will. And, I mean, Windsor's got a good ball team. Mac's got a good ball team. You got to take advantage of it. So, I mean, there's definitely going to be some build-up or building on this game. But so far, I think they're accomplishing a lot of what they want.
Foul will again kick off short. Again, Devontae Hobbs will take it at the 20. Tries to pick his way to the outside. Finds a lane and will take it all the way out to around the York 46. Nice vision there shown by Devontae Hobbs, Wayne.
No, very nice. You know, and it's nice to see. I mean, this is a testament to Coach Craney and the rest of the staff at York. Is they're not folding it in. I mean, he could have easily just gone, followed the wedge, and gone and just gone down on first contact. But no, still bounced out. 32-point game at the halftime, but still bounced out. And like you said, showed that vision and showed the effort. And we're getting a look, Nate, and it should be interesting that Roberto Almonte, constantly injured, one of the keys, got a little bit more size than some of the other rush than say, Beck had. So we'll see what happens with him.
Yeah, Kachu again has to throw off his back foot, and that's just begging to be picked. And Chris Daly has it for the GGs. Looking to get a bit of his run on, and he'll return it to the 45 before Austin drags him down. I don't think interceptions get much easier than that.
No, I think you're right, and I think it's one of those cases where it's just, you know, I mean, again, and I know I sound like a broken record, and this isn't a disrespect to the York program. It is a building program, but you have two programs at different stages right now, clearly different stages, and, I mean, the good thing is you don't see the blatant discrepancy, if you will, as you do in the south of the border, where you have at least two or three of these games on everybody's schedule and everybody, and, you know, you have the haves and have-nots. Yeah. But it's definitely one of those games where I mean, this York team is not quite there yet to be at the level to really compete in the OUA.
Yeah, Nugent remains on the sideline. That York starting corner, Bila Small, now in at that position for York. Completion goes to the short side.
See, now here's the case where I guess you kind of want to, this is where you might kind of, where you leave Aaron into the game there. Is that you want to see him, and this is kind of where you might want to see Aaron go ahead and see if what he can do in the two-minute drill. I mean, this is the type of situation. Well, I agree with what you and Tommy were seeing, but I definitely want to see situational. Otherwise, get Derek in there. Get him some reps. I mean, again, I just and you hit it on the head with the Gibbons story. It you're playing with fire.
Yeah. It was officially a gain of 8 for Simone Lamarcomp. Brendan Gillander's still in the game, gets the handoff, looks to have the first down at the center stripe. Brendan Gillanders really hasn't piled up the rushing yards. He's been more of a just move the chains, hit it up there between the tackles type guy today.
No, definitely. And the GGs have had a couple of big plays. And like you hit it on the head when Lamar Carr had that drop with the big window you spoke of. I mean, the GGs, and you talked about the cushion that they're given. I mean, their guys haven't been open. They've been open. Like, I'm talking the capital big O open. I mean, it's just... And so as such, they haven't really had to diversify, for lack of a better term.
Colbin, straight drop on first down. Bogdan Ryak, nice little sideline catch. Fights off the tackle and takes it down to the York 33 before being brought down by Corey Bellardon, the St. Pete's product.
And what seems to be happening here is it's just, I'm not, and again, I know it sounds, because I'm really kind of focusing on the DBs here for York right now, and it just seems like they're late in getting into their zone coverages. I mean, I'm watching the halves on the wide side that have the field, and they're just getting there so late.
And again, same pattern to Ryak, that down and out, and he'll drag Bellardon inside the 15. And that, is, like again, Wayne, that is just like That's like kid in a candy store stuff right there.
No, and Reich at 6'2", almost 220. He goes into 218. You can't give him that underneath stuff, or what's going to happen is exactly what you said. He will drag DBs.
Yeah.
I think we got a timeout York here.
Yeah, Ottawa had sort of gone into a hurry up in York. And the Lions will call timeout to sort of just settle their defense. Seen a lot of a hurry-up offenses recently because Toronto runs it almost, I'd say, 75% of the time. They ran it last week against Queens. I mean, they can get...
Well, what Toronto does, and we talked about, is Toronto runs kind of a leverage game where I love the term that that Boomer Esiason used to use with Cincinnati or the old Buffalo Bills, is they had their hurry-up and they had no huddle, which they said are two different things. And, I mean, the Bills ran it, and it puts pressure on the defense. I mean, obviously, hurry up cranks that pressure up. And, I mean, I think that's what Ottawa's trying to do, and I like that. I like the strategy by the offensive coaches here. I mean, again, forget about the 35-3 score. You have a situation that you may encounter later on. You've got your starting quarterback. You got the ball at about the 45 or 50 to scrimmage. Try to punch it in. Treat this as if you're playing Western and you're going in to get the key points at the half. Treat this as if this is McMaster and you're trying to get that score to win the game at the end. You know, these type of scenarios. And it looks like they're approaching as such, which is the only way you can approach it at this point. I mean, you have a half of football left. You don't want to go into dormant stage. But, I mean, if you're going to leave your starters in there, you have to give scenarios that are going to be, if you will, conducive to them getting better.
1:05 before the half, first and 10 on the GG14. Colbin going deep in the end zone and in for a GG TD. Lamar Caw again.
Wide open. Wide open.
A little too easy.
I know I'm flogging the horse, but it is just, you're watching, and I mean, it's just basically, I mean, you've got two styles, and I apologize for anybody out there that knows this already, but I mean, you have your basic cover three, which appears to be what they're in. And, I mean, you have your cut and your hold. And, I mean, basically the first letter is what is kind of definitive of what the coverage is. I mean, on the cut coverage, the corner has the flats and the halfback goes up top. And on the hold coverage, the half has the flats and the corner goes up top. Now, traditional wisdom dictates that, I mean, you're going to play cut usually to the boundary, to the short side, just because it's much too far a run for your half to get out all the way to that field side. So if you're going to play hold coverage, if you're going to play cut, it's going to be to the short side. I've been watching now the last few times. They've been in cover threes, but I mean, they're, and you can see that they're going there, but their breaks are painfully late. I mean, this is something that, yeah, if this is the NFL, you can disguise it as such. But yeah. These guys can't disguise it. They need to stop doing that. They need to just break into it, get to their area, because, I mean, it's not a point of being actually out-athleted, as I said earlier, Nate. They're just not getting to where they need to be. Yeah. And, I mean, credit to Colbin. He's making the throws, but it's not like he's like Dan Marino, like they're just, you know.
Yeah, he's just lofting the ball in there. Like
exactly.
And again, I mean, what you're talking about, Wayne, those coverage issues for York, they're exacerbated because you meet with the 65-yard wide field as opposed to the 53 you'd get in the States.
Well, that's exactly it. And, I mean, if you're not going to get to the flats, like you look at it, it's 24 yards between the hash mark and the sidelines. So, I mean, you're looking at 41 yards of open terrain that they just don't seem to want to cover when you're on either hash.
Yeah, Felvo with a little sand wedge kickoff taken by Curtis Price makes one cut and gets out to the York 34. Another update from... down in London, Ralph Griffin's now up 10-6 on Western.
And wasn't that the score of York? Wasn't that a mirror of last week's 10? Wasn't that 10-6 last week?
It was 10-0, I believe, right off the hop. And
I got to give you credit, Nate. You're clearly a better golfer than me, because if your sandwich is looking like
I don't even golf. I can't even figure out what hand I'm supposed to, what side I'm supposed to hit it with, because I'm left-handed.
You know, that's a good excuse. I'm going to start using that as mine.
All right, make it yours. Just if you sell it, people will believe it. Sevden back in at quarterback for what will likely be the Lions' final series of the first half, as we're down to 53.7 seconds. 42-3 is the score right now. Sevden with a nice completion over the middle to Jesse Merton before he's brought down by a gaggle of GGs at the York 50. Gain of 16.
And again, this
York likes to use that H-back there. That was an instance of it.
No, definitely. And, I mean, this is, this is one of those things where you see, and you hate to see it, because these young men, they go out, and every night after or before class or after class, they're out there practicing their butts off, and they're working at it. So, I mean, hopefully they get some degree of success. Or you hate to see the 42-3 at halftime type scenario.
Going back to Jesse Merton there, it looks like they may have found something they could expose in that GG defense underneath.
Yeah, run that little quick in. It was Trevor Seal and Sumbam Cha making the last tackle there as York moves it now to the Ottawa 47. Sevden now tries the long out, caught by Janelle Tolbert, and he gets racked up pretty good by Dustin Wilson.
Well, right now, Ottawa's pretty much content to give them anything they want underneath. I mean, York hasn't shown it. They've got 34 seconds left, so Ottawa's saying, you know what, if you can nickel and dime us 40 yards in the last 34 seconds, more power to you here.
Let's just get out of here, get to the halftime, and reevaluate and get our second string.
Sevden sets and goes deep for Tolbert, but just a little overthrown. Dustin Wilson had the coverage there. Matt Bond was flying over the top, too.
I got a question for both of you, because this is why I alluded to the whole concept of Noah Brindis and Jesse Palmer, and I understood exactly what they were trying to do. You had this young kid who would play.
And Rex Grossman, for that matter, who worked himself into the mix as a true freshman.
Yeah, but he wasn't there then. They didn't have, because this was
that Palmer's, was Doug Johnson.
That was Doug Johnson. Johnson broke his leg. Palmer was supposed to be redshirted and was 6 months away or 6 months removed from the quarterback in the Myers Riders here, and got his first start.
Playing a bowl game.
And got his first no, but he got his first start in Jordan-Hare Stadium against Auburn. You know, it's a tough call. I mean, Myers is one of the premier programs, but might not be Bradenton or
say the Thomas Aquinas.
You know, these type of things.
Or Matter Day.
Yeah. So, anyways, my question for you is this, guys: is that we saw it with Brindis and we saw it with Palmer, and you knew why. You had one that was infinitely talented, and you had one that was that veteran guy who was, you knew he was going to be a coach someday, and that he wasn't going to NFL. In this case, I haven't, and I don't claim to be the York play-by-play guy, so I don't see them each week. I haven't talked to the coach. I haven't been down there to see practice. But right now, I'm seeing a lot more success or poise out of Coteau than I am the other one. Like, I mean, it's just, it seems like some of the plays are there, and they're just not getting the ball there. And whenever I look up, it seems to be 12 missing as opposed to 7. Nate, are you seeing anything, or Tommy?
Yeah, well, Sefton's the pocket guy, and you'd think he's the one who really depends on the rhythm.
Ooh.
Here, this is a short field goal by Dervishi. He's going to be well short. Cha, who had a big return earlier, will bring it out of the end zone. A flag is down as it looked like Williams blocked a man in the back. Two flags go down.
Three flags.
You know, to answer
there's the third one.
To answer your question, Wayne, I think it sort of goes back to the situation that the football team is in. You know, obviously it's in a state of turmoil right now, being winless and not having made the playoffs in many, many years. I really think you're just going to try and take advantage of any potential situation that may arise. So if it does mean mixing your personnel at the QB position, I think they're going to try and do anything they can to try and generate some offense and generate some success here, because, you know, when you're winless and you're on the road, and you'll do anything you can to try and generate some
Oh, agreed. I completely agree. I'm just not seeing any production coming out of Sefden. Like, yeah. I just haven't seen it. I've been watching the plays, and it seems like Coach is a little more on points and a little more poised sitting that. Where, again, I can't stress enough, credit to the York coaching staff. I mean, they're putting their players in a position that, if executed, it's successful. I mean, they're beating the Ottawa U. I guess you could see strategically they're beating them. I mean, not beating them, but you know what I mean? They're getting in places where they could make it competitive. I mean, York has missed at least four or five wide-open guys. And, Tommy, just, I know this wasn't the one you were bringing up, but funny enough, we've determined that Jordan Nugent is no relation to Ted Nugent, but he did go to St. Thomas of Aquinas.
Oh, all right.
Now, unfortunately, I don't think it's the same one you were thinking.
Not the one where Chris Carter is coaching his son, I don't think, in Florida.
So GD's in victory formation. They'll kneel out the half. So 42-3 for Ottawa, two touchdowns in the first quarter, four in the second quarter as they, I guess the natural order sort of took over. York getting on the board with a field goal late just before the break. I guess we'll step aside briefly. Wayne, we're going to get a halftime guess, I guess?
Yeah, no, well, he should be. Hopefully we'll get Phil David. We'll be able to bring him on here, and we'll be able to talk about the breast cancer awareness program that Ottawa U's doing, but that'll probably be early in the second, as I know that they probably got some halftime stuff.
All right.
And Phil's also an ex-O lineman, and I'm only talking 1 year removed, so for Phil to come up to the broadcast booth, we've got to give him a couple minutes.
All right, until then, we'll step aside. You're watching GG's Football on Streaming Sports Network Canada. Welcome back to the second half of GG's football live on Streaming Sports Network Canada. Nate Sager, Tom Casagrande, and Wayne Jacobs. Proud to bring you the action on this beautiful summer-like Saturday afternoon in the nation's capital. GG's up 42-3 on the York Lions. Just checking elsewhere around CIS football. Light schedule on this Saturday with a couple of teams moving their games up to weeknights. And Canada West, of course, takes the entire weekend off on Thanksgiving.
Before we get going here, Nate, I must correct myself. A couple of times I mentioned that the York University Lions were winless when, in fact, they actually have one win under their belt this year against the Waterloo Warriors. So my apology to the York team and York fans out watching live on SSN Canada.
Yeah, 20-18 in overtime. It was a squeaker.
All I know is this, is that anybody at York there, Tommy is from Toronto and will be heading home on Monday, so you can sort him out accordingly.
We'll give his license plate number in a little while.
I don't live in the beaches.
we'll give some out-of-town scores here from across the country. Lavelle Rouge-Or in a dogfight with the Montreal Carabins in a matchup of two ranked teams. Lavelle only up 9-3 at halftime. Kickoff by Dervisky.
Montreal has had some success against Laval in the past.
Yeah, they beat them back in 2009, taking at the 13, a decent return. And again, Hussein Hazimi is down there for the York Lions. Also in the Quebec Conference right now, Concordia Stingers up 19-11 on McGill at halftime. They had a pick six touchdown just before the break. And out down east, the Acadia Axemen lead the Mount Allison Mounties 19-0. And, of course, the game in the OUA that we were mentioning earlier, the Western Mustangs have broken on top of the Guelph Griffins 13-10. Andrew Thibodeau with a touchdown catch just before the intermission.
Eventually thought that game would turn itself
on. Yeah, we've seen that from the Mustangs many a time. So first and 10 from the 30. I believe Aaron Colvin's still in at quarterback.
Shockingly, he's so.
Hand off inside. Frank Nagundi breaks into the open field, and no one will catch him. Nagundi's going to take this in, an 80-yard touchdown run in for a GG TD.
Wow. Right there, we're witnessing the depth of the GG backfield with Frank Nagundi coming in relief of Brad Galanders. And he certainly took advantage of his opportunity, Wayne.
No, definitely. I mean, we saw it there, and that's the type of thing you want to see. And, I mean, it's also the type of thing you want as a coaching staff to realize whether you have or not. A very good job by the offensive line opening that seam. I mean, we've seen it all year, and we saw it last year. Shavin Fernando, probably the anchor of that O-line, the veteran center, a great young man, outstanding football player, and you saw that kind of the A and B gap. He had his choice between the two because they were basically combined into one big, huge hole. And, Nate, you brought up the score with the McGill-Concordia game. Interesting side note, has a little bit of a local flair to it, as it's basically a battle of two minds, if you will, of two ex-GG minds. Ex-Ottawa U offensive coordinator and assistant coach Danny Laramie going head-to-head with ex-Ottawa U defensive coach and assistant coach Phil Roberts. And about there, Phil Roberts, the DC, and Laramie, the OC at McGill. So if they actually get a chance to listen to this one afterwards, a special shout-out to both of them, and we'll see who wins that battle of ex-GG coordinators.
And just quickly to run down some stats, obviously have to – not too hard to update from Ottawa after Nagundi goes 80 yards on the first play of the half. He's actually Ottawa's leading rusher now with 84 yards just on two carries. Gillander is 11 for 34, so sort of a quiet afternoon. Aaron Colbin, though, 12 of 19 passing, 279 yards and three touchdowns against one interception. Simon Lamarcant, 131 yards receiving, and Bogdan Ryak had 109. On the York side, and the number's not quite as bountiful, Jesse Merton, their leading receiver, three catches, 29 yards, but Dimitar Sevden struggled, 7 of 19 for just 33 yards. That's Nick Kachu, 3 of 4 for 19 yards. So, yeah, Kachu did have a bit more of a rhythm. There's Janelle Tolbert, and Tolbert gets a bit of a lane on the kickoff before he's brought down around the 35 by Ettore Latanzio. Flag is down.
It'll be interesting to see if York continues their rotating quarterback offense or whether or not they just stick with Kachu here.
Checking numbers there as the Lions come in. Come out. And the penalty was on the GG, so it looks like it's going to move York up. And again, it is Sevden who took the lion's share, pardon the pun, of the snaps in the first half. The penalty moves York out to their own 54 as they look to get their first touchdown of the afternoon. were able to get a couple of majors on the board last week against Western.
His GG defense is relentless.
They call it, you know, controlled chaos. Pressure up the middle on Sevden, and his pass is broken up by Dustin Wilson. Really been impressed with Dustin Wilson every time we've seen him get some time at cornerback this year.
Nice job by Wilson there. I mean, it looked like that could have went either way in terms of he looked like if it was almost perfect timing, almost too perfect. But, I mean, obviously the refs were right in front of it, didn't got the flag, so great job by Wilson. And I'll be anxious. I mean, again, we got to, if you're the GGs, you have to avoid any type of drop-off here because this is a collision sport. I mean, this is injuries happen in the 59th minute as they do in the first minute. So,
yeah. Sefton with pressure, and he is going to be brought down in the backfield. Sack, I believe it was Latanzio getting in there. And that'll bring up a punt. First sack of the day, I believe, by either team.
Sack on the play by Latanzio.
Loss of six officially, so Gerard David back into punt.
Latanzio, a classics and ethics major, certainly showing some classic form on that play, Wayne.
Definitely showing ethics by not doing anything to draw the flag. So
I took a classics course one time. The final exam was multiple choice, though, so I don't think they were too serious on us learning about the Greeks and Romans. Punt bobbled by Ian Stewart. Now he's running east-west in a north-south game as he's brought down. Nice tackle made by the York Lions' Norman Craig.
If he didn't make that tackle, it looked like Stewart was going to be gone down the sideline.
Norman Craig from Shelburne. I remember meeting some people from Shelburne at the World Junior Hockey Championship last year in Belleville, and let's just say those guys knew how to enjoy themselves.
Where exactly is Shelburne?
Somewhere near Barrie, I'm guessing.
A little bit surprising here. We got Coleman coming back in for some more action. Again, I know it's only the 13-minute mark, but, I mean, at this point, really.
Sit him down. Sit him down. Get your backup some much-needed experience.
Yeah. Handoff goes up the middle to Alex Morrison on the old belly series, and he'll drag it out to the 31. Officially, it's going to be a gain of 8. Yeah, I'm with you guys. At this point, I think Derek Wendell should be warming up.
Gallanders is even in there in the backfield. I mean, like I said, I love the story you told earlier, Nate, because quite frankly, I mean, it's exactly what you need to avoid. And, I mean, you don't get it in the pro sports like you do in the call at collegiate level, but sometimes there are mismatches like this one. And, I mean, unfortunately, it is what it is, but I don't think anything's gained. And to be honest, we're in week 5 right now, or rather week 6.
Yep. Interesting alignment by the defensive front of the York University Lions there. 8 men on the line, all standing up. Have you ever seen that before?
Well, they did it earlier in the first half, and, I mean, they almost went to a fly. Like I said, they're presenting multiple fronts right now, multiple coverages. I'm just not sure. Like, I mean, and again, I can't stress enough. I haven't sat in on their meetings. I'm not privy to it. What I'm seeing might not be what the coaches are looking to execute. So by no means am I sitting here and am I able to critique it right down to the T, knowing exactly what they're thinking. But, I mean, I'm starting to get the impression that perhaps it's a little too complex because, I mean, in a couple of things, Nate, we alluded it to it. I mean, from a coverage point of view, it just seemed like guys were not even breaking to their zones where they're supposed to be. And as far as the fronts, I mean, this one clearly confused Ottawa because we got York first down.
Yeah, they come up with the forced fumble on Gillanders and take over. Sevden now completes over the middle to Tolbert on the slant, and he takes it for a first down inside the 15. Nice strike by Dimitar Sevden. It's going to be officially a gain of 18, and York is knocking on the door. The Lions move into the red zone.
Well, Sevden, using some of that height and arm strength that we've seen, I mean, the accuracy has been lacking a little bit today. But perhaps if he can get into a groove, we'll see, if you will, the faith that's been placed in him, see if it's warranted here.
York would love to get a couple of touchdowns here and have something positive to build on. Lofting deep for the corner to William Austin, and he's got it on the fade. Lions roar into the end zone. Touchdown, York. That's one of York's staple plays when they do get into the red zone is the fade to William Austin. Florida Gators style, because we were talking about them earlier.
William Austin showing great concentration on that play. And then it's a very nice fade route.
Not the prettiest ball, but the very effective one. That's the key.
Nonetheless.
And I believe, you know, the way Austin was able to get some separation there on the corner, and I mean, that I think gave them a little bit of leeway. Dervishi adds the extra point to make it 49-10. So York's on the board. Just checking scores elsewhere again. Now Concordia's gotten added another touchdown on a punt return. 26-11 now for the Stingers on McGill in the third quarter. Yes, with just a minute and a half into the third quarter. So not the only game where you're seeing scoring right off the bat in the second half.
Also, we're noticing in the Western game, outstanding tailback and arguably one of the best players in the country in his first true year as a freshman. Mr. Varga, the running back for Western Ontario, was 70 yards in the first half again. He potentially could break the single season touchdown mark this year. What an absolute stud this kid is.
He played in the OVFL last year.
He did. I spoke last week to a couple of members of the Western alumni, and they all said the same thing with this kid. Just an absolutely great kid, tremendous athlete. Just turned 18, and he is absolutely the real deal. Had a couple offers to go down south, but also a straight-A student. His school is important to him, so he decided to stay home and go to Western.
And Soonbom Cha, we're turning it out to the 30 before he's brought down by Hussein Azimi.
Varga, very reminiscent of another legendary tailback out of the Mustang program, Tim Tyndale, who went on to have some success with the Buffalo Bills.
did he ever? Two at Crichton's, too, I believe?
Two, and would have had three if he didn't get hurt that the in-between year, if you will. You can ask Brian Cox, middle linebacker from Miami Dolphins, if he knows who Tyndale is. He blew by him for a 40-yard touchdown in an AFC divisional game at Rich Stadium, as it was then called, now called the Ralph.
1995, that was. Nagundi in at tailback. He has a chance to go over the century mark. Did it almost all in one play. Quick throw to Bogdan Ryak, but his knee touched down, so it's only going to be a gain of one. Aaron Colbin still in at quarterback, much to, I think, the astonishment of all three of us.
Certainly.
As the GGs have a... insurmountable 49-10 lead over this York Lions team.
It's one of those things. And Tommy's point's not lost, what he brought up earlier. And, I mean, I'm looking at it in the approach of the corners. I mean, if I'm the GG's defensive coordinator, I want to see my corners out there for the entire game. They're young. They need to be tested. And they got shell-shocked against Laurier. I mean, this could also be seen as a confidence builder. Colbin clearly was overmatched, if you will.
Colbin is picked off. Jordan Nugent gets his second INT of the afternoon.
Colbin also took a big hit on that play there.
It looked like Azimi was pressuring him, and he just lofted it up there. Almost just threw it up down. You just don't want to launch the ball into center field like that.
No.
Even with the score being what it is, but, I mean, it's all about good habits.
Yeah, exactly, and that's what you're trying to do is develop good habits. And again, as I mentioned earlier, that's the type of play you're not going to be able to get away with against Western or Laurier, for that matter.
So York now, maybe their spirits boosted a little. I mean, give up a touchdown right on the first play of the half, but then come back, put together a touchdown drive. Their defense has now come up with back-to-back takeaways.
Absolutely.
Sevden now double pumps and a nice catch over the middle.
Great catch.
By Jesse Merton with Trevor Seal in coverage. Seal helps set up with himself.
Jesse's having a very solid game today. Again, as I mentioned earlier, they're having some success attacking the GG defense underneath a little bit here between the secondary and the D line.
Yep. And officially, they're not going to give Merton the first down. It looks like about a foot short. Merton out of White Oak Secondary School in Oakville. I just really like the way he just, you know, can extend for those high passes. He's got those, you know, great tight end hands. You know, they look like baseball mitts.
Middle,
looks like York might just be a quarterback sneak situation here with Sevden. He bobbles the snap, and loose ball. Looks like he was able to get back on top of it, and by the time he did, the ball might have rolled far enough for it to move the sticks. That's why I think that might be the first time today we've seen the quarterback under the center for the Lions.
Looks like he didn't get it. They're looking at third down here. I have to wait and see about the spot.
As they unpile down there at around
he's
the
short.
50 yard line. He is short. Wow. Actually did lose yardage. And York, they actually are bringing out the punting unit.
This I'm a little bit baffled on here. You've got less than a yard. It's third down. You're inside the GG territory. Why are you not going for this? You've got a little bit of momentum here with your offense, Wayne. What is the point in punting the football right now, down 49-10?
You get no argument from me. It's the same thoughts I had when they were going for the field goal down by 28 on with 2 yards to go.
Literally, if the quarterback just holds on to the football, he can fall down and he'll get the first down here. This is just.
But one might argue that's what they could have done on second down.
Well,
and it's a fake. Gerard David is going to run, and now he will rugby-style punt it. He takes a hard hit from, I believe, Latanzio. Soonbaum Chop picking it up at his own 15, looking to get to the corner. And he'll finally be tackled by who else? Hussein Azimi at around the Ottawa 17.
I
don't know. Was that a design fake? And it was like punted if it's not going to be there?
Yeah, no, definitely.
Design where you had the option to kick here. But again, just going back to the decision here, if you're going to fake the ball, fake the punt, I don't understand why you're doing it when it's third and 6 inches to go. I mean, you do it when in a completely different situation. You do it in the first half in your own end when it's third and forever. You don't necessarily do it when the team is going to be backpedaling. You don't do it in a situation where the defense has got their pump block formation in and you've got literally 6 inches to get the first down. I just, I really do question the call there by the York University.
What I think has to be remembered, though, is with this coaching staff, and I think it's a good thing that Craney's doing. I'll touch on in a second.
Gillander's still in the game. Takes a couple tacklers for rides before he's brought down after a short gain by Dustin Plett.
It's one of the things that they are doing, and I think that it's something that they have to do, and it's when we were talking about York's success or lack thereof over the last two decades in CIS football, or more particularly the OUA and previously the OUAA, is the continuity of it, the coaching turnover. And I think what Coach Craney's trying to do is establish a program. And, I mean, part of that, even though on a October afternoon, losing 49-10 or whatever the case may be, I think part of it is kind of establishing that. See what you have. Oh.
Bad snap, and Colbin's in a race. He might have to fall on this. This could be a safety, potentially. Did we have a weirdly, or
yes,
did we have
is.
A quick whistle?
No, they got a safety.
Oh, it's Wendell back in at quarterback. It is going to be a safety. So, excuse me, Derek Wendell finally gets some action at quarterback. Thank you, Tom. And it's a bad snap.
Again, with that formation, Wayne, where not just eight, but nine men standing up at the line of scrimmage here, obviously proven to be effective for the York Lions.
Well, definitely giving the flat top look, trying to put pressure. And, I mean, probably good for the new quarterback coming, or probably good to give the new quarterback coming in a different look. But now, what I was alluding to, guys, is just that it was, if you look at it, and a lot of things I like that Coach Craney is doing, is, I mean, I think he's looking at this as a complete big picture type thing. I mean, just like we were talking about, Ottawa has to approach. They're up 35 points at the half or 32, and they have the ball with the minute something left. Approach it as if you're playing Western, like we were talking about. Approach it as if it's McMaster, and as if you're trying, okay, this is a two-minute drill. Forget about our opponent. Forget about the score. Let's try to execute. Well, I mean, you hit on it, Nate. You mentioned how many kids or whatever, how young they were up front. And, I mean, this is a program that hopefully they're looking to keep the turnover to a minimum, and some of these first-year starters on the O-line that come 2012, 2013, they're still around.
I agree with you on that, Wayne, but at the same time, I think you also have to give your kids an opportunity to put the ball in the end zone. And in situations where you do only have that 6 inches to go to get that first down, and your offense is showing a bit of life here, you're showing some momentum, I think you got to roll with it, and I think you got to go for it in that situation.
Disagree completely, simply because if you look at the score, Tommy, you got 49-12, they haven't scored. They scored one time, that's 6 inches. I think they're looking at the big picture, not just this game, but the season, as well as going forward, as they have to do, as the team has only won one game this year and hasn't had a lot of success lately.
Frank Nagundi in on the tackle as Tolbert brings the kickoff out to the 40. So I guess you could add on to that. I mean, it ultimately did work out for York. I mean, I don't think you could ever predict the other team is going to have a shotgun snap from its own 22, bounce roll all the way to the end zone. But
we don't know that. Maybe that was the genius behind Coach Craney.
All part of the plan.
And Michael Falls.
Well, Snake, the great thing about our country is that we're all entitled to our opinion. As crazy as yours might be, you're equally entitled.
Sevden back stays in at quarterback as York starts from its 40. Again, with the empty backfield look, Sevden looking right, has a man open in that. And it's Tolbert for a first down. Nice strikeout to the 51.
This York receiving core has impressed me a little bit today. I know the score is 49-12, and they're not exactly lighting it up, but they got a couple kids out there that can absolutely play. You put the ball near them, they'll go make the catch. They'll come across the middle and make the tough catch. They're not, they're better than the score is indicating right now.
Yeah, Janelle Tolbert, fourth year eligibility, 6'3", 210.
Big kid.
Out of St. Martin. So he was able to nestle down into that little hole
in
the zone.
Jesse Martin, Austin Williams. We got some guys that can play here.
Sevden again throwing underneath, and that was high. Dustin Wilson had a better shot at it than Tolbert did.
And, I mean, the looks are there. Again, we've been saying it since the first quarter. The looks are definitely there. I mean, they're building something here at York. I mean, hopefully it continues and it grows and they kind of and they can look across town and kind of, and I mean, obviously we're not looking at somebody who's completely gone from rags to riches, but at least now they're moving in. We saw them, Nate, and I mean, they're not quite there yet, but they're moving into that middle echelon, and that's the U of T, the Blues program. And hopefully York can kind of build up that slowly but surely and kind of get in there. Because, I mean, there's definitely something to the system.
Sevden has trouble with the shotgun snap. Now he's flushed out to the left, looking to just dump the ball off, and they'll just finally loft it as the flag goes down. Might that be intentional grounding?
I'm not sure.
He's well outside the tackle box.
They may call pass interference on the, on, I think that's number 81 out there for York. It might be some type of interference on him. As, I mean, he was engaged as that ball went in the air and was hitting his man. That's Robinson Weeks.
And again, indeed, the signal looks like it's against Ott.
It's going against York.
York, but we're not sure. Yeah, we're not sure on the call, as Tom mentions.
We'll wait for the stadium announcement, which could be a mistake in itself. But so they did get the intentional grounding on that, and I mean,
a little baffled on that call, to be honest with you. Clearly outside the tackle.
I mean, it's just a totally broken play, and I mean, the smart thing for Sevden to do was just loft it into his team's bench area and live to fight another series.
And but I guarantee you that Sevden, on that thing, what Sevden does there is that if he, like, I think that's a poor call, because I think if he sees, or if he's not allowed to throw it at that point, I think he's a good enough quarterback. He drops it over the receiver and makes it look like it's the general area.
Great punt by David, and that is going to bounce out at the Ottawa 6-yard line. Beautiful punt by Sevden. Officially, I think that'll go as a 56-yarder. By Drawer David.
Drawer David has had a very good game today punting the ball for York. He's gotten a hold of a few of them today.
And York taking a somewhat unusual step. They actually do have two kickers with Dervishi and
Seems like they have two of everything, Nate.
Yeah.
Well, you know, Wayne, we talked a little bit about this earlier, about not wanting to put your young quarterback in a difficult situation, but here we find him in a very challenging situation to start his second drive of the day, starting at his own 6-yard line.
No, but I think this is a scenario you want to get. You want it, like, I mean, obviously in a 49-12 game, it's hard to emulate something that's going to be, of any major consequence.
Yeah. Wendell throws his first pass, and it's a completion. Ian Stewart cuts back and is finally rocked by Hazemi at the 30-yard line. Gain of 24.
Showed some nice poise there, the young QB did.
Yeah, nice. Put some nice air under that ball and just gave Ian Stewart, who's been really impressive in his cameo appearances at wide receiver this year, a chance to make a play.
First year kid out of Belleville, Ontario, home to the Shad brothers. For those of you that can remember Mike Shad, first round draft pick by the LA Rams out of Queen University.
Hey, I interviewed Mike about 6 weeks ago for one of those "Where Are They Now" sort of type deals. And pass into coverage. Bellardine was all over Riot. Crowd calling for a pass interference flag.
Rightfully so. I'm surprised the flag was not thrown on that play. Yeah,
it looked like there was contact well before the ball arrived, and it was certainly not of the incidental variety.
It's one of those things that always makes you wonder. If you're on the game long enough, you just kind of you roll with the punches. But, I mean, and again, 49-12, I'm sure that the York coaching staff isn't going to pinpoint that as where the game went wrong.
Certainly not.
But on the other hand, I think it's just blatantly obvious. I mean, Bellardine went right through him, and no flag. So,
well, Derek Wendell will now try to pick up a 2nd and 10. It was good on his first pass, and we've got a flag before the snap.
I think we've got a false start here, I believe, or procedure.
Legal procedure, GG's.
And indeed is the legal procedure, so 2nd and 10 just became 2nd and 15. Update from London now. Tyler Varga has got his 14th touchdown of the season now.
He's rolling.
Yeah, and as Tom and Wayne talked about, Western now starting to assert itself, now up 23-10 on Guelph midway through the third as they look to stay unbeaten. And, of course, we still haven't got a Lavelle update. And Lavelle, of course, was in a tight one. I mean, we could see a change at the top potentially. Wendell now, deep ball, plenty of air under it. Potential pick and knocked down by Ryan Porosnik, York's defensive halfback, and that'll bring up a punting situation for the GGs.
I think that ball hung up there a little bit longer than Wendell would have liked to have.
Well, when talking about Western, Nate, I mean, I, I, I don't know. You got to look at it. Like, it's like you said, is it a case of great adjustments, or is it a case of them just, like, you know, coming out and kind of, because that's, I think, the third or fourth week we've seen it this year against various opponents. Like,
yeah, we saw it against McMaster.
We saw it against Ottawa. We saw it against, you know.
How many times do you see a team play down a level to their opponent, and sometimes once in a while it comes back to bite them? But, you know, I think, you know, Western's the type of ball club that, especially Coach Marshall being as intense as he is at halftime, will make the necessary adjustments or just read him a riot act to get that team fired up again.
There'll be no travelers for the Western team, that's for sure.
Devontae Hobbs takes the punt and returns it to the Ottawa 46. Bit of a short kick, so only net of 21. You got a flag down, though.
End of man for the GGs.
Yeah.
Can't make out who that is, Nate.
That's right. It's offside on York, so it could be a potential re-kick situation. And trying to pick up the number on the injured GG. One of the, looks like it was one of the linemen.
Hopefully nothing too serious here.
It's actually Trevor Seal, starting linebacker. And starting front seven player, because he lines up linebacker and end. He's down getting some attention.
Oh, he is. You said something there, Nate, and I think you alluded to something, whereas this is where Ottawa's really got the difference safe between this year and, say, 3 years ago or even a couple years back. Even last year, they didn't have the depth that became synonymous with in the latter stages of the Pichet era, whereas you could just interchange. Like, I mean, Mike Cornell is a perfect example. You have somebody here that's seen significant time in the CFL and didn't really crack the starting lineup as a full-time starter till his last season with the depth at linebacker that they had. And you see it, this is the difference with this team, guys, is they just do not have that depth. And they're already an undersized defense, and they're not quite as quick as, say, some of the recent additions of the GG's defense. I mean, their current strength and conditioning coach, Mike Sheridan, was part of what I consider to be the best linebacking core I've seen since the Gord Weber Jeff Sims combination.
Arguably even better than that era.
And you know what? I know, and that, I'm being fair to that era, Tom. I agree. I think
it's played with that era, and I'll tell you right now, this one was better.
They were the speed that they had and that they ran around with. I played linebacker in high school for a bit, and these kids made me want to go back and start over and play linebacker. They're just a great bunch of kids who just seemed to have fun, and every coach feared them. And I remember having an interview with the old old Guelph coach, and York coach for that matter, back in the day, Tom Arnott, and he referenced it. He said, you know, what do you do against a team when there's nobody in the league who'll argue that three of the top three linebackers are playing for the same team? And that's what they basically had.
The thing that impressed me the most about that group was that every one of them could go sideline to sideline.
Oh,
they all had tremendous speed, athleticism, and they all loved to bring it. And they're a really fun to watch group of football players.
And meanwhile, the most physically talented of the bunch was probably watching from the sidelines was the monster Cornell. So, I mean, we don't see it. They just don't have that depth, and you alluded to it. With Seal going down, I mean, they've got Roberto Almonte back, and, I mean, that's important because Almonte has been a little bit injury-prone over the last few years. But he adds a little bit of size that hasn't been there. Another Griffon product, and he adds a little bit of size that hasn't been there.
Yeah. York trying another different offensive look now as Kachu ran the option on first down and pitched to Riser Markell, the rookie running back, for his first carry of the day. And Markell picked up almost a first down, nine and a half yards. Markell, one of five different, I believe five players on the Lions who went to Chaminade College in Toronto.
I think we're going to get a measurement here, and I think, Nate, you alluded to something here with the other look, and I think that's one of the things that they're going to have to correct, or not correct, but choose going forward. And, I mean, a lot of times with desperation, when you're not experiencing a large degree of success, you're obviously going to try a lot of different things to try to do it, because that is the beauty. That's what makes this game so great, is unlike all the other major sports, you can line up a physically and athletically inferior team and still get the W, and do it with some consistency if you out game plan, out coach, out this, out that. There's a lot of options. And I think that's what they're looking to do right now. I think they might even be out coaching themselves, though, in the sense that it seems like they're having defensively they seem to be struggling with some of the looks that they're giving Ottawa, in the sense that, I mean, it looks good and they're doing something, but there's always seemingly somebody out of place. And then offensively it seems like they're, you know, they've got a lot of different looks for that require different style of players that you can't have all in. So,
yeah. So second and inches officially. Sevton comes back and again has trouble with that snap, but it looks like this time he hangs on to it and will move the chains to the Ottawa 40-yard line or so. We're down to 2:14 to go in the third quarter with the GGs up 49-12 here.
You mentioned earlier about the Chaminade, the kids from Chaminade High School, Nate. All five of them also happen to be in their first year with the York Lions, so obviously the coaching staff has developed a bit of a pipeline out of that school to really build a foundation upon. So very good on Chaminade College School.
Sevden back in shotgun formation as York again with that, using a tight end again. Sevden looking left, throws the slant to Torbert, and it's intercepted. Dustin Wilson down the sideline. There's a block. This could be coming back. As for now, it will stand as a pick six, but there's a flag down at the York 50-yard line. And that's, so Dustin Wilson's would-be first career touchdown may not stand. We also have Tolbert down injured back at the 25-yard line.
Looks like it's coming back. Our first pick six of the year. Looks like it will not stand.
Yeah, again, holding against Ottawa. And I think it was a fairly obvious one. And when you have, you know, defensive players trying to block for the interceptor, that's oftentimes what happens.
We'll still see the offense run the field for the GGs, and much better starting field position for the young quarterback here to try to assert himself a little bit in the lineup.
Yeah.
Interesting to see how they will handle Derek Wendell here. If they'll open it up a little bit as we saw earlier in the game with Aaron Colvin.
Yeah. You don't want to be having them throwing deep balls when there's like 5 minutes left, but you want to make this worth it for the young man.
But you know he's one play away from being your starting quarterback, so
no,
you have to get him
exactly,
that
and that's so. One yeah. of those outs that he will get. Like, I mean, obviously, if there's a minute left and he's throwing bombs, they'll go down. But I mean, the other coaching staff has to realize that he needs to get his playing time.
Wendell
as well.
Indeed will try a deep pass, and it's juggled by Bogdan Ryak in tight coverage and an incomplete.
And quite frankly, I mean, and again, you want your players looking for the hit. But if Corey Bellardine looks for the ball, as opposed, and again, not a shot on Bellardine because obviously that ball's tipped, so he's thinking he's got to go to receiver. But if Bellardine doesn't make it up there, he's basically knocking. He's basically got the pick, and he's got himself and a couple of GGs between him and the end zone.
Now second and 10 for Ottawa. Go back to that double tight end look that we've seen from them many times. Looked like it was almost offside. Wendell now has a completion to LaMarcon. LaMarcon will be wrestled down at the York 42. Look, and I think you're right, Tom. I think they had it offside down to the short side of the field.
Simon LaMarcon continuing to have a big game here today. It's got to bode well for his confidence moving forward. And, you know, it was great to see the young quarterback there. Put a little zip on the ball. I mean, he had a couple of balls there that were underthrown, and nice to see him step into one.
Yeah, I think by our math, I think it's seven catches for 151 yards now for LaMarcon. We're down to 40 seconds in the third quarter. York again showing that shifting front. Inside handoff. Nagundi's got a bit of a lane. Run for a tackle. The ball is stripped. Who's got it?
And that's been one of the...
And York has it.
And if you will, that's been one of the downsides with Nagundi is breaks open and kind of carries it to out there. Guys, I'll be honest with you. I'm going to actually hammer back the point I brought up earlier. I mean, they've got too many darn looks, I think, this York team. Because I'm watching that front. And I mean, obviously, 49-12. So we want to see the adjustments they make. And I mean, they've got guys stunting that have no business stunting. Like, I mean, you're putting six guys in the box. And I mean, which is great. But you got to also know your talent level. I mean, it's great to say, okay, I'm gonna have a guy out in the corner and he's my shutdown corner. But I mean, if he runs as fast as myself and he covers about as well as I do, you're in a whole world of hurt because he's never going to cover anybody. And they've got guys, and it's a great scheme, but they can't play to the scheme. I mean, this backer's not even a factor, and the last few plays. I mean, I think that what they really got to do is they're trying to establish something here, and they got to settle into that.
Yeah. And it was Marcus Grandison was the one who ripped the ball out. And again, York, we talked about these different looks. Riser Markell gets his second carry of the day and brings it out for a first down, a gain of 16. And Kachu is back in at quarterback as well.
I think you make a great point there, Wayne, about, you know, playing to your strengths and building your system around the talent that you have as opposed to trying to insert the talent into your system.
Yeah.
Well, it's definitely that, and it's also the fact that, I mean, they just seem to have a bunch of different fronts. And, I mean, it's one thing to confuse the opposition, but it's a totally other thing if you're taking your
you're confusing yourself.
Yeah. Final play of the third quarter. Mark, this time it'll be Kachu, and now he's in trouble being chased out of the pocket. Will loft it toward the sideline. A flag goes down, and it's probably going to be on Ottawa. As I saw Tolbert go down, but
they best call that holding, because if they call that pass interference.
It almost looked like Tolbert thought it was a run. He was trying to block.
It was. What happened there is you'll see it. Nate alluded to that. They like the H-back. You had the H-back. That was the H/slot/tight end. That was Nathaniel Griffith. And, I mean, unfortunately, we can't show you the replay, but he came right across there. That was going to be a shovel pass that Ottawa blew up.
Yeah. I mean, there's... They certainly did, and I don't know how you can throw a flag on that play there against the Ottawa defenders.
You got to call it holding. If they don't call it holding, this is a travesty, and I'm agreeing with you, Tom.
I don't think there's a reason to throw a flag whatsoever. Holding.
There you go. You got it.
They will pick the flag up.
That's the right call.
I guess on those things like that, I'm kind of a purist. I don't like when a team like messes up a when the offense messes up a play, and then there's a it results in the defense taking a penalty, because it's like you got rewarded for not executing as well as you could have.
No, hey, you know, it's exactly it. But unfortunately, sometimes football emulates life, and a lot of times we get rewarded for things not doing what we should have done, Nate.
Yeah, so that is the end of the third quarter. Margin is still 49-12.
Nate, much what we thought.
Yeah, but we'll give some credit props to York's defense. They've come up with, I guess, four turnovers in that third quarter. Granted, GGs are running in some backups at the, we've got Wendell in the game now, running in some second stringers at the skill positions. But still, four turnovers is four turnovers. That's something for them to take into their next game.
You don't want to see this going down the home stretch.
Kachu now on that designed rollout will look for an opening. Gigi's fly up to the ball very well. And he's brought down pretty much at the line of scrimmage. That was on 2nd and 10, so it's going to bring on the York punting unit.
Unfortunately, they got in. This is one of those things you got to wonder. And, I mean, Kachu, he gets up. Hopefully he's okay. He's okay there. But, I mean, that's another thing. Again, a fourth-year guy, you kind of expect him to say, hey, Nick, you got to know this. You played this GG team four times in your career. This is your fourth time. They've got speed. You can't roll out and then stop. And I think I'm just looking over there, and I see a big man climbing up the stand. You can't quite see him, but I think we should have Phil David in our booth momentarily to discuss the breast cancer awareness, and we'll talk a little bit about his thoughts on this game so far.
Gerard David with a nice punt. Taken at the 25. Ian Stewart will look for a middle return. Finds a bit of a lane for a decent 10-yard or so run back before being brought down. Looked like it was Nathaniel Griffith in on the stop for the Lions.
Run by team number 80, Stewart.
Finally getting Ian Stewart and Frank Ngundi straight, 30 and 80. But I noticed on Twitter, I'm not going to say which Ottawa media outlet was, but they credited Ngundi's 80-yard touchdown run to Soonbom Cha somehow, who, of course, plays defense.
Yeah, that'd be a tough one.
But 10 and 30.
For Soonbom to claim.
I think in terms of IDing players, there were no two more confusing players in the CIS the last 5 years, as the inside handoff goes to none other than Frank Ngundi, who stood up by Michael Livingston after a game of four. We got two York players down on the same play.
We got victims of the Malachi crunch.
As Zach Davis is hurt. As Zach Davis and Steven Reading are each down. Patrick Russell's credited on the tackle. Thank you.
Fans, come and support our women's hockey team as we face off against the Concordia Stingers.
Not a bad average for Frank Ngundi after three quarters of play.
Yeah, three carries, 96 yards.
32-yard average.
Yeah, those are some PlayStation 3 numbers.
Tecmo Bowl.
I was going to say.
Dating myself going back.
Yeah, I was going to say, I'm not playing against you. I still haven't got that PlayStation 3 figured out there, Nate. I got to do Tecmo, so I know I'm not playing against you. Lord knows I don't get those yards in PlayStation 3.
When you get a running back who breaks one like that in the video game, that you're almost tempted to bench him just to protect that yards per carry average. Of course, Brendan Gillander is having sort of a quiet afternoon. 13 carries for 39 yards and two touchdowns. I guess he's been the singles hitter. Ngundi was the home run hitter. Mm-hmm. Aaron Colbin is Zach Davis is up. Stephen Redding also getting to his feet for York, and that's good to see. Colbin, 13 of 21 for 280 yards, 3 TDs and 2 picks. As overall, a pretty respectable afternoon. Lamar Conn, the leading receiver on the day, 7 catches, 151 yards and 2 TDs.
Huge day for Simo. I wonder if they'll keep him in, try and get him that 200-yard mark.
Well, the GDs had someone go over 200 against them last week, but I think at this point, I think you'll stand on 151.
Something you don't see too often.
Still in the ballgame, though.
The second string and third string quarterbacks helping the defensive end off the field. And you'd think that York might want to arrange that a little better and have some bigger bodies, but you had
Kachu
and Frank in there carrying them off.
They're showing some leadership skills there.
Hand off to Nagundi as he looks to go over 100 yards, and I think that he'll get it with that play as he took the outside zone for about 7. And indeed, that gain of 7 will
take him over that mark.
Yeah, up to 103 on the afternoon. I really like the way Frank Nagundi runs.
Well, good for him. It's well deserved and looks good on him. He's a heck of a back to have back enough Gillanders, I'll tell you that.
you need 2 tailbacks in this day and age. I mean, you sort of have to have a defined. You have to have it defined who's going to be the one.
Well, especially with an inexperienced quarterback, you like to see that type of depth in your backfield.
Wendell now has a completion deep. Maxime Moreau down, first down inside the 10.
Great ball by Wendell.
And it's funny because you used the term earlier and I liked it. I don't know if I'd go as far as saying great. Incredibly effective right at spot. So, yeah, it's great in that respect. I don't think I've seen it. Wendell's got a weird hitch to it or something where his balls just don't turn. Yeah. They don't turn over.
Looks like officially I think they'll give him 44 yards. First catch of the day for Maxime Moreau.
Well, he led his receiver perfectly, and he showed a lot of poise back there in the role. That's something you want to see from a first-year kid.
As I told, tell all my kids that I work with, I tell them I go probably the ugliest ball, but at the end of the day, he always had a 75% completion ratio with Ty Detmer when on his way to the Heisman Trophy. I mean, I was lucky enough to be standing on the sidelines against Ty. I watched him, and this was a guy who you're like, he won the Heisman because he looked like nothing. He didn't. His balls were wobbling, but then you realize he threw 5 incompletions out of 35 passes and torched it for 350 just with no spirals.
Well, as Vince Lombardi once said, we will all be judged at the end of the day by the same thing, and that's the result.
Yeah, but didn't Vince Lombardi also say 3 things can happen when you do the forward pass and 2 are bad?
I thought that was Bo Schembechler. That was it.
No, I think Bo stole that from Vince. But it might have been.
It would apply to Bo. It would have applied to Bo's
Bart
Michigan team.
Starting backfield, you let him open it up.
Yeah, and it looks like a successive procedure penalties. It was, that time it was the right tackle moving.
And it's tough right now, guys. I mean, this is
one of those things. It's a little hard to keep focus.
No, it really is. I mean,
a 37-point spread.
I mean, give them credit. We're all a little bit older, so we're supposed to be able to focus more. And since the kickoff, we've been talking tryptophan and turkey and waiting for the cranberry and the stuffing. And, I mean, these poor kids now, they've been kind of holding out. And now those thoughts, not to mention 22-degree weather here in Ottawa in the in October, I'm starting to think, man, I want to get this done so I can continue on with my lovely day.
And you've got a game to coach tonight, Wayne.
I do. Hopefully the weather holds up. It's the Griffon will be in Montreal, hoping to avoid going on the road.
Wendell's got to trust his wits here. He picks up a block, completes the Bogdan Ragan in for a GG TD. And we got an injured York defensive back down as Bella Small got shaken up, trying to make a tackle, but he's up and quickly. Might have just been Bella's pride that was hurt on that.
I'll tell you, Dimitri Dalakos just unloaded.
That old peel back when the quarterback scrambles.
That was a heck of a play to give his quarterback a little bit more time there. And one thing we're seeing from the youngster here is he's showing a bit of mobility, Wayne. He's showing he could actually make some plays with his feet as well as his arm.
I believe Derek Wendell from Belleville. That's, for those of you who know your high school regional associations in Ontario, that's CASA, Central Ontario. Has there ever been another kid from a school in CASA who is a good passing and running quarterback for the GGs? Guy who used to play here last year?
He wasn't too bad.
Yeah, Brad Sinopoli. He was all right.
He wasn't too bad.
That was the conference they were in?
Yeah, St. Belleville and Peterborough are like the same regional association. So.
Oh, very athletic family. I mean, you had Brad there. You had his sister who was on a soccer scholarship to the States. And, I mean, clearly they know what they're doing in that area of the province.
Yeah, and I also believe Derek Wendell, like Brad Sinopoli, was a guy who played everything. One of the great things of being in a moderately sized city like Belleville or Peterborough.
Well, that's what made Brad so impressive. How many quarterbacks can add Offsa Hurdler to their resume?
A javelin. tremendous golfer. I heard he actually turned down a scholarship to the NCAA to continue playing football here. And, you know, with his talent easily, if he had more exposure coming in from a larger city, a larger region in the country, easily would have been recruited down south. But much to the University of Ottawa program's luck, he was able to come up here, and they were able to land him.
I think one of the most, when it came to Sinopoli, I think one of the most significant moments was when we got out there and they had all those injuries in Sokobe's last year. And not only Sinopoli was a stopgap at receiver, he ended up being one of their go-to guys.
He wasn't he their second leading receiver? The year
I think he led the team in receptions in the playoffs in one of those two games.
Tremendous
or whatever.
Athlete. Yeah.
Just a phenomenal athlete and even a better person. I mean, I've had the chance to talk with Brad several times, to actually talk with Brad offseason. And, I mean, it's one of those things that it actually kind of almost reaffirmed or reignited my faith, or if you will, in the CFL. So I remember saying to Brad after watching his first 2 years, I go, you know what? We were talking about possibilities of him playing in Europe afterwards, and I mean, hopefully they open their eyes, because
yes.
I mean, this kid had everything you
yes.
needed, and I mean,
give the kid 2-3 years to develop, a la Aaron Rodgers in Green Bay, you know, let the kid learn the system for a couple of years, and give him a legitimate shot at being a CFL quarterback, regardless of where he's from.
Wilson broke on the ball and nearly had another chance at the pick six, but couldn't hang on to the interception.
It's not happening, Nate.
You're
not getting your pick six.
Well, we've still got, you know, next week's game.
Oh, no,
but, yeah, you make a bright point with, you know, just keep, you know, Danny Brannigan got a shot with the Argos, managed to stay on the roster the whole season, but, you know, when the handwriting was kind of, I think, on the wall when he came to training camp this year, that the Argos were going to go in a different direction. But Brad Sinopoli, you know, he's made a good impression in Calgary. He's got some, he's taken some snaps in regular season games, and we'll definitely see next year if the Stampeders have him in their plans. Deep ball for Austin in tight coverage and intercepted.
You know, a little bit more to the point about giving him an opportunity. You know, one of the biggest supporters of Canadian quarterbacks in the CFL is none other than Matt Dunnigan. You hear him on the TSN broadcast time and time again speak to the fact that he really believes that there should be an extra roster spot for any team who wants to have a Canadian at that quarterback position set aside for that so that they can develop and learn the professional game.
Yeah, it was Randy Williams on the interception, by the way.
Completely agree with that. I mean, you take a look at it, and I mean, and that's the other thing. I guarantee you, if Sinopoli's playing, like a Sinopoli or whatever, if he's playing and he comes back into town, and I mean, there's going to be many people or local people that want to come out and see a local product playing at the pivot position.
Sure.
And I mean, we see it time and time again in the NFL, for that matter. Quarterbacks that don't light it up for the first half decade of their career, but they manage to hang on,
yep,
and they become, some of them, very serviceable in the case of, say, a Van Pelt or a Shane Matthews, and other ones like a Jim Harbaugh go on to be, you know, pretty darn good quarterbacks for the latter half of their career, because it's such a cerebral position,
you know,
where it's learning.
We saw Chris Flynn go into the Hall of Fame this year, the Canadian Football Hall of Fame, and that's just a great example of an outstanding quarterback, outstanding athlete who really deserved an honest shot, never really got one, so it was very frustrating for many Canadian football fans.
You had me until you brought up. That's where I think it gets clouded, and I completely disagree with you. Flynn didn't have the quarterback potential in the CFL,
yeah,
and I think by arguing that, he should have been there.
And Frank Nagundy can wave bye-bye to the York defense as he'll take it, this one in, a fairly easy touchdown.
Nagundy doing his best PlayStation imitations today.
52-yard run for Nagundy.
That average is just going up.
He'll move over past 150 yards on the day, at least, probably in the 160 range now. And now it's just like York is just like hoping to get out of here, stop the bleeding and, you know, keep the score down to a respectable margin as it now grows to 62-12.
No, and, you know, just by continuing to run the ball, you can't really point the finger at the GG coaching staff of running up the score.
No,
here.
I mean, it was a straight handoff that York's probably seen on film a thousand times, and Nagundy just breaks it to the outside.
No, and because of the integrity of the league, you can't have a mercy rule or anything, but this is the type of thing, whereas, I mean, if they could keep the clocks running, I really think they should.
I think there are some levels of football, like, you know, even in high school, where if the score hits a certain point, like the clock, it'll be straight time,
sure,
the clock won't stop, like, for incomplete passes or out-of-bounds plays.
But again, as Wayne mentioned, that, you know, for the integrity of the game, you can't have that at the university level.
No.
Which is a shame, because I am feeling for the kids down on the York sidelines. I mean, this can't be fun. I know Tommy and I, we were on the wrong end of some scores. But fortunately for us, never, it was usually self-induced, for lack of a better term, in the sense that it would be tight and then we would just let it get away. And I mean, I've been fortunate enough only once or twice in the numerous years I played to really be, well, the Earl of March High School notwithstanding, to be at the wrong end of these scores. And I mean, it's just, it's not fun.
It's not a good time, no. Especially when you got a five-hour bus ride ahead of you.
Do you remember what the widest margin was in your playing
days? Tommy and I were talking about it. It was with Tommy, and it was in university at least, and it was probably one of the, and it was right here. It was the last weekend of October, and it was the polar opposite of this weather. We had back-to-back games, and I'm sure you'll be happy to hear this, Nate, against Queens.
Tolbert bobbles the kickoff, and will have to take it back into the end zone. This could end up being a single point as Wilson is one of the first GDs to the ball, and he's down.
Take a knee, son.
Yeah.
No, but just to continue with what is actually funny, you brought up Elberg. We were talking about Elberg and some of the Queens QBs, Pendergast and whatnot. It was funny because it was a game where we came in and when we met coach we were mentioning, Coach Roberts, great tactician, came in and said, okay, you know, we're going to shut down Elberg. There is no way Elberg's going to do what Elberg's done all game. Well, we certainly did shut down Elberg. We held him to 36, 37 yards rushing. Fortunately, Pendergast did his best Dan Marino on the day and passed for like 290. I think it was Tommy Cozen or Beresford, local product.
Paul Beresford, yeah.
Yeah, that ended up torching us for 100-something throwing. And, I mean, Ottawa used quarterback, who shall remain nameless, was pretty awful that day. So the next week we come here, and we're playing them at home, and it was the polar opposite. Elberg set the Canadian rushing record that day on a raining day.
Monster game.
And we were done at halftime, and I'm telling you, I remember it, Nate, like it was yesterday, because I can even remember where I was in the field getting hit. And, I mean, it's not anything, you don't say they quit, you just, it's hard. It's hard to say I'm going to give 100% physical, go toe-to-toe, when there's 10 minutes left and you're down by 30-some-odd points and it's cold and rainy. Fortunately for York right now, sunny and warm, and Tommy hit on it at the beginning of the webcast here. It's a picturesque sight. I mean, one of the next to North Carolina's Keysar Stadium, I'm thinking this is one of the nicest settings in the sports, and it's probably one of the ones that aren't known.
Tremendous venue, and we're really looking forward to seeing the Ottawa Sports Entertainment Group, what they're going to do with this park once it's all said and done. And so hopefully the friends of Lansdowne can finally get their you-know-what together and just let it go, because it's a battle they're not going to win, and it's just a handful of people delaying what is the absolute
scoreboard.
Inevitable. And this really is an eyesore for a location that has some great history in the city of Ottawa. And you talk about some of the struggles that Ottawa football has had over the years, and we finally have strong local ownership with the deep pockets necessary to facilitate this development. And then, quite frankly, the expertise in all levels, whether it's sports, business, or from the development side with those four key partners. And, you know, we're just really looking forward to seeing what they're going to do here, making this one of the nicest stadiums in the country and getting CFL football back to where it should be here in the nation's capital.
Yeah, and if you've seen the architectural renderings, what you'll have will probably be in terms of stadiums that are in that 25,000 to 30,000 seat range, probably one of the best in North America for football and soccer. It's just going to be
a tremendous venue, and not just the football and athletic facility, if you will, itself, but some of the other things they're planning on doing to really help rejuvenate the Lansdowne Park area and Bank Street community. It's just going to bode well for the future of the city, and quite frankly, you know, you're the only G8 capital city in the world that doesn't have an outdoor stadium venue necessary to hold some events, not just sports events, but
concerts. Of course we do. Take a look across from us. we can host the world here. What are you talking about?
And, of course, on the soccer front, Canada hosts the Women's World Cup in 2015. It would be nice to play, some games in your nation's capital. I think you're generally expected to do that when you host a World Cup.
Absolutely. It's only going to bode well, as I mentioned, for the city to really be able to showcase who we are and what we're all about here in Ottawa.
And nice return down the sideline here, down to the York 45. So, yeah, Wayne, I think I do remember that first of those two games in 92.
Yep, no, yeah, definitely.
I was at that game.
Queens homecoming. Yeah. We were all good. And the funny thing is we had just unbeaten Bishop's team that had absolutely destroyed Queens.
49-14 in the second game of the year.
But,
I was at that one too.
But the funny thing was is that 49-14 was such a non-indicator of what the score had or what the game had actually been. And so everybody thought that Bishop's was light years ahead of everybody else. And I remember losing by 1 point to Bishop's, or 2 points on the last play of the game.
I kind of had put that in my past, Wayne.
Thank you for bringing that up. No, no, my pleasure. trust me, we got plenty more we got over. You thought that's going to – it came back to haunt you now. But, yeah, no, and it's funny because everybody thought Bishop's was the class. In Ottawa, we went in, we were tight neck and neck with the Gators, and everybody thought it would be a great game, and we went there. And let's just say I enjoyed Queen's homecoming that night.
Ramon Monsieur got his first catch, and now here's another strike over the middle. Pass is dropped.
And the beauty with playing quarterback is they actually recognize you, Nate, and I think I got at least a couple of sympathy pops when I was popping in from house to house, and that's not a word of a lie, true story. The coach we were talking about, Sir Winston Churchill, Steve Cook, we're out with him later after the game. We stick around for the whole Queen's homecoming shindig, and at least two places, and I mean, God love the Queen's football fan, they at least acknowledge their opponent. I got... Hey, weren't you that the quarterback for the – yeah. Oh, man, I'm sorry. Here's have
beer.
One.
That was a pretty – obviously, that was 92. The Queens went on to win the Vanier Cup that year, and they had a very good front four. Eric Dell was the big pass rusher.
Yeah.
Over the middle on first and 15, and Wendell almost intercepted by Jordan Nugent, who was going for the hat trick.
Why do you have to keep bringing up the year? Why can't you just let us pretend like it was only 10 years ago, Nate? That's like three times you brought it up, 92. 92, and it's echoing in my head right now.
I was 15, and I was a Blue Jays fan and a Chicago Bulls fan.
Your world doesn't get any better than that.
Yeah, it was all. It's all been downhill since for the last 19 years. Oh, sorry. Last 10 or so years.
That's okay. You've already dated us. You've outed us in that
respect. I think I was more dating myself. I'd be more worried about dating myself on that. Wendell now trying to pick up a second and 15. Will throw the deep corner.
Oh, had a man.
Again, making the right reads. And, I mean, ugly balls. But until that one, they've been seemingly getting there.
Yeah.
And, I mean, like we said earlier, it's the effectiveness. You need to get it there.
In this situation here, what Wendell's getting is some much valuable playing time and reps more than anything. So that the next time that we have to turn to him, you'll see him a little more poised, a little more under control. He'll make those throws next time he's in there because... the offensive coaching staff will take a look at this on the film, and that's one of the things they're really going to break down in a game like this. Sure, it's great to see your first stringers light it up, but what's most important is you want to see what you've got for the future, what you've got for your backups to see what they can do in certain situations.
So are you maybe saying that they should have brought him in when it was 21-0?
I think he's gotten... oh!
Matt Falvo has the field goal blocked, and this is a free ball. The Lions will just fall on it. Emerson Morisuti covers it up at the York 38, so a nice special teams play by the Lions.
I think Wendell's getting enough playing time here today. So? I think, again, as I mentioned earlier, if Aaron was in his fourth or fifth year starting, perhaps they would have pulled him a little bit sooner, but as his first year of a starting quarterback going down the home stretch, you got to get him some playing time. Let him put up those big numbers. Granted, it's against a weaker opponent, but just build up that confidence heading down the stretch.
Big numbers, it does seem like he put up.
Yeah, well, Wendell's been able to, I think, been probably up in the 150-yard range just from playing the second half.
Sure.
So York opens on the 38 now. So they've, again, looked to maybe just try to get one more touchdown. Kachu running that option pitch to Riser Markell, who makes a nice cut, and will have a gain of about 7. Been a while since we've seen a true option play. You don't see that a lot in Canadian university ball.
Not a lot. But
Phil Cote used to break it out back in the day.
Another tremendous quarterback from the Story GG program. One of, I think, only two quarterbacks in the history of the program to win both the head Creighton and national championship.
I think you are correct in that one. I think Smitch did not win it.
He got to the finals, but I think Paul Patton did one, but did he not? I could be wrong. That legendary 75 team.
He did win, but I don't think he won that year.
Yeah, Phil won the heck his first year, or excuse me, his second last year, and his last year he won the national championship. Team led by Marcel Belfoy, current Hamilton Tigercat head coach.
And that 2000 GG team has the distinction, I believe, just one of three CIS teams to ever eliminate Lavelle and go on to win the Vanier Cup.
Yeah, that's certainly when Lavelle was just getting going. But nonetheless,
Lavelle did win in 99. So
they weren't quite what they'd become within a couple of years. They were a dominant program then, but Marcel had put together a hell of a program in his own right, and which is why he went on to the professional ranks.
No, and one of the things that you guys that you touched on is it's not so much where Laval was, but at the time you didn't have Sherbrooke nor did you have Montreal.
Sure.
So it was a two-team race to see who could get those great francophone players out of Quebec.
Certainly.
I mean, one of the things, all due respect, he went on to great CFL notoriety was Coach Daly. I never played for him, but you did, Tommy. And
yes.
I mean, this is not meant as a disrespect, but one of the oversights, I think, from the Daly staff was that I know when I got there, and it was one of the things that kind of regenerated the program because it was that got it going in that direction again was Coach Roberts' ability to go into Montreal and get those players. And it was almost before Laval, it was a no-brainer. And I mean,
I totally agree. And that really did help turn the GG program around. And in deference to Coach Daly, the talent pool was not there the way it is today. The number of kids playing football in Quebec was a lot less than what you see right now. I mean, of course, Quebec is an absolute hotbed, you know, the leading province in the country producing some just tremendous. The football programs across the board in Quebec is just outstanding. And you know, Wayne, because you are now coaching at the CJEB level here in the Outaouais region, so you can attest to this more than anyone, but just amazing what the football program community has done in Quebec.
You hit it on the head, and that's the thing I'm noticing now is that you go and you look at some of the programs here in Ottawa, the great ones, the St. Pete's, the St. Matt's, and I mean, this is not any disrespect intended to the coaches that are there. Great coaches putting in tireless efforts to get these teams ready and prep the players. But even a powerhouse like St. Peter's or St. Matt's, I mean, with the exception of Ashbury, you only have
We're now playing in the independent league with the other private schools.
Exactly. You only have two or three dedicated coaches. CJEP, exact same age group these kids are at. You know, one like these kids in grade 12 now, instead of not having a dedicated position coach, they're being coached up like university. So.
Sure.
They're getting here. I mean, just the fronts that they're going to be, it's light years different.
Mark Stevenson has gotten back some burn at tailback, and he's had three straight carries now to take it inside the York 30.
So
showing a nice burst. And another out-of-town update from London. The Guelph Griffins just refusing to go quietly into the good night. They've closed to within 24-22. Mustangs had a bad punt snap go for a safety as they're playing with fire, although Western's, they're still probably in a position where they could go finish 7-1 and
still win the conference.
And still finish first in the conference because, McMaster, they've got the tiebreaker on McMaster by virtue of beating the Marauders. And now, if I'm not mistaken, is it Windsor is it not on their schedule? Am I right on that?
I have to take a look at that.
I'm not sure of, but having said all that, I mean, I think Guelph Western would probably be less of an upset than Toronto-Ottawa last year. And, I mean, exact same scenario. Ottawa's only blemish in the regular season coming to the Varsity Blues.
Yes.
And indeed, Windsor and Western don't play each other. And I'm just thinking with start to get into points for and against scenarios, which
records
is, of course, the that's the tiebreaker. And it's in all games. And I think Western's had some pretty wide margins this year.
Very impressive to see Windsor in the hunt this year.
It's good to see them back. Definitely good to see them back. I mean,
Coach Joe DeMore doing a great job. And Austin Kennedy, one of the most exciting quarterbacks in the country.
Yep.
So Ottawa first and down 10 of 29 after the three big runs by Stevenson. And why not give it to him again? This time, though, a nice tackle by Hussein Hazimi.
Remember last year when Gillanders was out hurt, Stevenson got a lot more playing time than he has this year. And nice to see him get the ball again.
Yeah.
It definitely shows the depth that they do have at running back. Sorry, Nate.
Yeah, mark that down as a gain of two. I guess it's kind of getting redundant to keep giving the yardage, but with the score line being what it is, we're down under 4 minutes. Sorry about that, Wayne.
Yeah, no. By all, like I said, we're not going to lie, nor are we going to try to make this as what it's not. We're trying to follow the game and keep you entertained here in the 52-point differential.
Yeah.
I don't think he got the third down here. Might see Matt Falvel come on.
Yeah, it's going to be short. Corey.
Do you go for
Michael
it,
Livingston.
Do you go for it?
not with this score. Michael Livingston and Corey Bellardin were in on that stop.
That would be bad karma, Wayne.
I think you're right.
That might come back to haunt you.
I remember a lot of people getting on Greg Marshall back during when he was at McMaster once because I think they were beating Toronto 69-72-0 or something like that. And it was third and one. It was like at about 12. And he's like, okay, we don't really want to kick a field goal here because that's really rubbing it in. So they call a full. They hand the ball to their blocking fullback who almost never got a carry. And what happens? Takes it up the gut for a touchdown.
Well, you're damned if you do. You're damned
exactly.
If you don't. Right?
Yeah,
if you
took a knee, you'd be really.
That'd be the biggest insult. Yeah, certainly. Yeah, he was even accused of running up the score this year against Waterloo in their first game back after a year suspension, and certainly wasn't a pretty ball game. But, again, you know, what are you going to do?
Funny thing is, Nick, no one's able to ever define what running up the score is, but everyone knows it when they see it.
No, I really like Mike Dick's answer to that, and it's quite simple. Just stop them. If you don't like a team run up the score, well, then just stop them.
Yeah, Felvo, it's a 27-yard try for Matt Felvo. Actually, I believe his first field goal attempt all day. He's just been kicking extra points, and he drives that through. So bring the score into 67-12 with 2:53 left in this football game.
It's got to be a little demoralizing for Matt because, I mean, he was one of the
It was wide. So it goes for the single, 65-12.
He was one of the he was one of the preseason favorites to be the conference kicker. And I know that Matt's a team player, another one that I've had the opportunity to work with as a coach and also get to know. And, I mean, quite frankly, he just he gets so limited chances to kick. I shouldn't say limited, but you only get a certain number. And I know he's got to be really disappointed with himself. He's going to keep it inside. I mean, obviously with the big win. But from a personal point of view, you know that Felvo cannot be happy with how this one's gone. And I'm taking a look at him now, and he's kind of probably the only Gigi who, if you look at him right now, over at the end of the bench, knee down, looks like he's basically on the wrong end of a 64-12 game.
Kachu puts plenty of air under it, and it's caught on this deep ball. Nice catch. It looks like that was
Willie Mays Hayes style.
That was William Austin.
Catch.
Yeah, that was William Austin. Who else?
Yeah, that's a very good ball game here today. Showed great concentration again.
Yeah, 35-yarder.
So the ability to go deep and get open. If he's led a little bit more, he's walking that one into the end zone.
I'm thinking that's been the tale of this one, though.
Yeah.
Just a little bit more, a little of this, a little of that. And
yeah, and with that miss, by the way, Felvo just 5 of 11 on the year. There's another nice ball, but I think Austin was just a little late turning to look at it, or it wasn't thrown in stride and goes incomplete. But, yeah, William Austin has just really been the offensive leader of York. But coming into this week, I think he had almost three times as many yards as any other Lions receiver. Not something you really want to have because that's not really sustainable. But, I mean, you got to go with your moneymaker if he's what you got. So York would like to, you know, get one more on the board here with the score at 65-12. They throw the dump off on the screen to George Daniel, picks up a block, looks to be close to the first down, maybe a yard shy.
Okay, so Snake, are we going to see York go for it here if they're short, or do you actually kick the field goal?
Soonbaum Chaw made the tackle.
You know what, you
gotta
me
go
this
for
a few
one.
Hours ago, I think they're going for it, but then when I see them kicking field goals to...
Well, it's even a little bit longer than that one questionable situation where they did actually try to fake punt there, but I think here they're going to go for it.
And no doubt about this is Kachu will probably look to maybe try the sneak.
He
stood up, but he reaches the ball out, and that's going to make a close measurement. I believe Tom Casagrande's called it right. He's short.
Yep.
And I do know it's late in the game, but come on. You're a fourth-year guy. You can't see. I don't know if you guys caught that. Ottawa U presents the bubble. No defense in the world is going to leave. They open the bubble up right now, and basically Kachu got suckered into it. They opened the bubble. He went where it is, and they had two backers shoot in there.
Yeah, John Beck down injured for the GGs.
Not good, as we saw Trevor Seal go down earlier, Nate.
Yeah, that's something you want to see in a ball game like this, especially.
Yeah, Seal has come back in the game, so.
And now Beck seems to be just like having injury problems continually. So, like we saw it last game, didn't we see Nate, where he came on and off the field about four times.
Yeah.
And I mean, not a shot at him. A couple of them were big blow-up hits, but I mean, hopefully this isn't. This has no relation to 2 weeks ago, because I mean, right now, especially getting into the meat or the home stretch, if you will. Or what baseball players refer to as the dog days, you can't. You want to know that you have this because, like I said, depth is definitely an issue for this team. We'll see what happens.
Yeah, and Beck, I mean, he's a guy. They list him at 6'1", 201, and he's playing there, playing with all those big linemen. He's putting his body on the line. Just to correct myself, the Felvo actually 10 of 15 on the year. So that sounds a little bit. It sounds a little bit better.
Well, it's good to see Beck walking.
Looking
off
at the wrong column there on the stat sheet.
Yeah. Definitely sounds a little better, but definitely I guarantee you not what Matt Felvo had envisioned coming into this season as one of the preseason picks, not just to be all conference, but possibly be all Canadian.
Yeah, he was thinking 80% on field goals and 10 out of 15 or 67%, and indeed is York shy of the first down, so a turnover on downs.
And we talk about Matt Falvo, and, you know, he's one of the very few, if not the only GG kicker I can remember in a long, long time to actually have a legitimate shot at a pro career. GG program, obviously very storied, has produced some tremendous amount of football players at the professional level on both sides of the ball, but not too often you see too many kickers coming out of this program. So it'd be nice to see Matt really hit his stride, if you will, down the stretch here and give himself a chance to get a look at playing at that next level.
Yeah. No, and you hit it on the head, Tommy, just because he has that. It's actually funny. His predecessor was the one that's gotten the best chance to make pro previous to that, but he lacked one thing that unfortunately is one of those kind of qualifiers that you have to have in the CFL. And I remember Chobanian, who was absolutely impressive, but he was almost the opposite in the sense that they wanted him as a punter.
Yeah.
And he told them, like, yeah, but listen, I'm not a CFL kicker. I'm a CFL punter. Mm-hmm. And he still went to Winnipeg's camp. Now, Chobanian had one of those chemical engineering degrees or whatever where his starting salary would have been double that as a kicker in the CFL. So it was a bit of a no-brainer for Ara. But
nice block.
And there's a huge hole for Stevenson as he shoots down the left sideline, cutting it back before he's finally wrestled down at the York 48.
Well, I think Stevenson's going to give Ngundi a battle for best yards per carry average today.
Yeah, I mean, Gillander's, it was, chipping away 3-4 yards at a clip when he was in the game, and now those two have just run wild in the second half as, York's spirit has sagged and as the score has mounted.
Well, I'm sure Brendan is feeling very good for his backfield mates here, having some opportunity to play and put some numbers up.
Andrew McMillan was in on the stop for the Lions. There's an inside handoff to Alex Morrison, and he'll just move the pile.
Tough run for
about six, Larry Zonka style.
For both teams, I'm sure. Right now, you're just looking at that clock, hoping that it just ticks away. Because Ottawa, right now, this is not a position you like to be in. I mean, every play has the risk of injury.
Yeah.
And for York, right now, you're just wishing you could fast forward at 6 hours where you're getting off that bus.
Down to a minute left in the game.
It's a long drive down that 401.
And I don't think you'll see anything but straight handoffs from the GGs as they just try to bleed out this clock.
Yeah.
As they'll I believe a time count violation likely.
Looks like that, yeah.
And of course,
unfortunately for the GGs, because this will now bring up a loss of down. So, I mean, we're going to go to third down here under the conventional rules by the...
Yep.
And, of course, we've got to mention our next broadcast of GGs football on SSN, of course, next week. Windsor Lancers come to town. Currently nationally ranked, coming in their game against
Queens
tonight. That is a big one because, Ottawa...
For both clubs.
I mean, Ottawa will be in a situation where they pretty much almost have to win that one to give themselves a shot at hosting a playoff game. Let's just put it that way, because they'll be coming in at 4-2. Windsor at either 4-2 or 5-1, pending their result. Ottawa's still got to go to McMaster.
Yeah, no. For Western to stay in the hunt, for Windsor to stay in the hunt with Western to win the division, they're going to have to win outright. And as you mentioned, GGs would like to host, and obviously, and for them to do that, they're going to have to win outright themselves, with already having a couple of losses on the record.
Yeah, you've got Mac, like currently Western 5-0, and their game still in the balance against Guelph. Mac at 5-1, Windsor at 4-1, and then of course you've got a couple teams at 3-2 with Queens and Ottawa will go to 4-2 momentarily.
I should get an update on that score.
Oh, did you guys just see?
He could have ran for that first time. Yep. Easily.
No, and you know he was thinking that about it too. He's like, oh, they're going to kill me if I do this.
Yeah.
But as they had the punt return team on, they all kind of backed out of there. And the high snap, Falvo kind of stunned there when there was absolutely nobody in front of him for at least 30 yards.
And again, we had a lead change in the Western game.
Wow.
As they're now, they went... Guelph took the lead, but Western's back on top, 31-29. And according to John Matisse's Twitter update, John's a friend of mine,
yep.
Brian Marshall caught the touchdown pass. Coach Marshall's other son, the one who plays receiver from Ben Rassong, who's supposed to be the QB of the future in London, is Donnie Marshall's out with an injury. 70-yard bomb. So 7 minutes left to go. Western up 31-29. And Guelph, I believe they're still playing their freshman quarterback, Jazz Lindsay.
Wow.
Daniel gets the handoff for the Lions and picks up about seven inside as we're down to 24 seconds.
That looks like the type of ball game that whoever has the ball last is going to win that game.
And they've had a couple. Guelph and Western have played a couple of those. They had that one 41-39 back in 2009.
Yep.
I don't think you want to ask Justin Dunk about that game.
Yes, no. Justin, let us know
what he felt about
the Mustangs prior to that.
Yeah, Justin's a great kid, though. And the irony of course, now Justin's trying to move into sports writing and broadcasting.
Yeah.
Actually doing a great job of it. But, yeah, I mean, that was one moment where the emotion kind of got the way of him. And that will be the last play of the game as the GGs bottle up Daniel on the inside handoff. Great doing this game with you guys, Tom and Wayne.
Thank you very much for having me here, gentlemen. I had an absolute blast. It's always good to come home and watch a bit of GG football.
No, I want to thank you, Nate, for allowing Tommy. We try to make it a yearly event here. Hopefully it'll become known as our Thanksgiving Classic, where we do the old Monday night. We bring it to Saturday afternoon.
Yeah.
But, Nate, always a pleasure. And, Nate, I'll let you close things up, and I'll leave it at I'm looking forward to a game that's going to have some serious playoff implications and should be a little bit closer than this afternoon's game.
Yes, the GGs move to 4-2 on the season, while York drops to 1-5 with the result of Ottawa winning 65-12. We'd like to thank you for joining us here on GGs Football and Streaming Sports Network Canada. Have a happy Thanksgiving, and we'll see you next Saturday at 1 p.m. Eastern when the Windsor Lancers come into town to take on your Ottawa GGs. For Tom Casagrande, for Wayne Jacobs, for our producer Ryan Essery, I'm Nate Sager. Have a great weekend.